In the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. And the earth was without form and void. And darkness was upon the face of the deep. And the Spirit of God moved upon the face of the waters. God said, "Let there be light," and there was light. And God saw the light, that it was good. And God divided the light from the darkness. And God called the light day, and the darkness he called night. And the evening and the morning were the first day. And God said, "Let there be a firmament in the midst of the waters, and let it divide the waters from the waters." And God made the firmament, and divided the waters which were under the firmament from the waters which were above the firmament. And it was so. And God called the firmament heaven.
Although we weren't able to shatter that highest, hardest glass ceiling this time, thanks to you, it's got about 18 million cracks in it.
One of the strangest places on the ocean's floor was only just discovered in the 1990s. And my degree is one of a handful of people to ever see it in person.
Without a doubt, one of the most amazing things that I had ever seen in the bottom of the ocean. It was while filming for Blue Planets in the Gulf of Mexico. I noticed there's something out in the distance. Couldn't tell exactly what, but it looked like a dark band. And as we approached it, the dark band became a donut. I saw this donut, and it was black in the center. What the heck is that? And so, as we get closer and closer to it, I noticed that the black band had what appeared to be kind of steam over it. And then I looked, and there was water lapping against the shoreline. This band was a ring of muscles. And inside the ring of muscles was a lake. And it's like, wait a minute, I'm already underwater. And we went out over the water in this lake and tried to descend in it and bounced off. It was so super saline and dense that the submarine couldn't go down it. We literally bounced off. And as we bounced off, we sent ripples heading back the shoreline. It was insane. I've never seen anything like it.
And God said, "Let there be lights in the firmament of the heaven to divide the day from the night, and let them be for signs, and for seasons, and for days and years, and let them be for lights in the firmament of the heaven to give light upon the earth." And it was so. And God made two great lights, the greater light to rule the day, and the lesser light to rule the night. He made the stars also. And God set them in the firmament of the heaven to give light upon the earth, and to rule over the day and over the night, and to divide the light from the darkness. And God saw that it was good.
By the word of the Lord were the heavens made, and all the host of them by the breath of his mouth. He gathereth the waters of the sea together as an heap. He layeth up the depth in storehouses. Let all the earth fear the Lord. Let all the inhabitants of the world stand in awe of him. For he spake, and it was done. He commanded, and it stood fast.
And we'll begin with simply the concentric patterns in the water as the frequency begins. Every once in a while, we'll reach a key threshold resonance, such as that moment right there. And in that key threshold resonance, the entire pattern morphed into a more complex expression of itself, simply because the frequency changed. Now watch what happens. The frequency is still increasing. Now watch what happens. As we reach another key threshold resonance, this entire pattern will morph into a beautifully and more complex pattern of itself. Again, and again. And look at this pattern right here. Look what you're seeing right here. Look at the beautiful geometry. Here is a perfect cube. There's a perfect tetrahedron, a star tetrahedron. In two dimensions, we've got the octahedron. Very powerful images of sacred geometry held in place simply because we've achieved the vibratory pattern that allows that.
and the fifth angel sounded. And I saw a star fall from heaven unto the earth, and to him was given the key of the bottomless pit.
If there be found among you within any of thy gates, which the Lord thy God giveth thee, man or woman, that hath wrought wickedness in the sight of the Lord thy God, in transgressing his covenant, and hath gone and served other gods, and worshipped them, either the sun or moon, or any of the host of heaven, which I have not commanded, and it be told thee, and thou hast heard of it, and inquired diligently, and behold, it be true, and the thing certain that such abomination is wrought in Israel, then shalt thou bring forth that man or that woman, which have committed that wicked thing, unto thy gates, even that man or that woman, and shalt stone them with stones till they die.
I wanted to start this video off with an introduction so that I could be certain to get your attention, because in this video I'm going to reveal to you what the Lord has shown me over the past 3 years and show you just how deep the rabbit hole of deception goes in this world. In Luke 8:17, Jesus states, "For there is nothing hidden that will not be revealed, and there is nothing concealed that will not be known or brought to light or made manifest." In the introduction, I provided amateur video of clouds passing behind the sun and the moon, which if you are really paying attention, you should be asking yourself, how is this possible if the sun and the moon are as far away as we've been taught, or I should say, programmed to believe? You also watch Mike DeGroy describe how there is water below the waters in the depths of the ocean, similar to what's described in Genesis 1:6, where it says, "Let the firmament divide the waters from the waters." I also provided amateur video footage of stars, which the Bible describes as heavenly hosts or angels that have a constant rotational path that does not change, with the North Star Polaris being the center point that remains constant and does not move. What I found amazing throughout my research is that stars give off the vibrational frequencies and have the same characteristics as the geometric patterns that are captured by a seismoscope when vibrational frequencies are applied to water. This led me to the understanding how frequencies are also a major contributing factor to the created geometric patterns that are found in the Kabbalistic flower of life, which is the metaphysical intersection of mind and matter, the spirit and the flesh, which is foundational to all ancient mystery religions. This is the moment that I started to understand why the Bible describes Satan as the prince of the power of the air. And finally, we're going to dive into the book of Genesis using the Strong's Concordance to trace back the scriptures to the original Hebrew text so that we can understand the truth about creation and unlearn the lies that we've been taught by religious institutions over the centuries. In my last video titled Tribulation Kickoff Events, The Phoenix Rising, I provided evidence to prove that there is a worldwide Luciferian agenda and system of control all around us run by secret societies such as the Freemasons, the Illuminati, and the global elites in every aspect of society that is designed to control and shape the moral fabric of society's beliefs and values in order to bring about Satan's one world government who will be ruled by the Antichrist. In this video, I'm going to prove to you that Satan, who is the god of this world and also is described as the prince of the power of the air, is actually the real puppet master behind the scenes, controlling and manipulating humanity through vibrational frequencies described in Ephesians 2:2 as the spirit who is at work in the children of disobedience, and also demonstrate how his spirit has manifested in the physical world in architecture, art, movies, commercials, and in every form of media throughout history and throughout every culture, once you have eyes to see. And I'll show you how this goes all the way back to the beginning in the Garden of Eden. By the end of this video, you will understand the truth about the human race, why we are here on earth, what our purpose is, and what happens if you die in your sin without your spiritual energy being converted to the Spirit of Christ, and everything in the world will start to make sense. You will also understand the mystery of our Heavenly Father's hidden plan in the Bible, and his indescribable love for us and hope that no one should perish in the judgment that is coming, and why Jesus says in John 14:6,
"I am the way, and the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. If you really knew me, you would know my Father as well. From now on, you do know him and have seen him." Philip said, "Lord, show us the Father, and that will be enough for us." Jesus answered, "Even after I have been among you such a long time, anyone who has seen me has seen the Father."
Jesus is the Lord God who came in the flesh,
They are one and the same. Therefore, if you are someone who believes that all religions worship the same God and we can all coexist, then you are rejecting the free gift of salvation that we have through Jesus Christ and are helping to promote the one world religion of the Antichrist. Jesus said in John 9, "For judgment I have come into this world to make those who cannot see, see, and to make blind those who claim that they can see." Jesus was not talking about physical blindness. He was talking about the spiritual blindness to those who were rejecting him. When you see what the Lord has revealed in this video, you will know that the scroll is open and that we have come to an end of a cycle, and Jesus is returning to burn it all. My hope in making this video is that I may help lift the spiritual blindness that has prevented anyone who watches this video from seeking a personal relationship with Jesus Christ while there is still time. To understand the mystery of the Lord God's hidden plan in the Bible, you must first understand that He is the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. He knows the beginning of the story from creation and how the story is going to end and everything in between. You must also understand that He is a loving God who is merciful, gracious, and filled with abundance of goodness and in truth. And His plan is to rid the world of evil and make everything brand new again. He gives us free will to choose our own path, whether we want to do good or evil, right from wrong, and even gives us a choice whether or not to accept His free gift of salvation that we have in Jesus Christ. I often hear people say that if God is such a loving God, then why does He let bad things happen? When you have finished watching this video, you will know the answer to that question and many others, and you will understand just how much the Lord God loves you and He wants a relationship with you before He returns to judge the world.
I am the Alpha and the Omega, the first and the last. The beginning and the end.
My Lord, I had been expecting death to come.
There will be no more death. Or mourning. Or crying. Or pain. I am making everything new. Yes. I am coming soon. May the grace of the Lord be with all God's people.
Amen.
How you are fallen from heaven,
O Lucifer, son of the morning.
How you are cut down to the ground, you who laid the nations low. You said in your heart, I will ascend to heaven above the stars of God. I will set my throne on high. I will sit on the Mount of Assembly in the far reaches of the north. I will ascend above the heights of the clouds. I will make myself like the Most High. And there was war in heaven. Michael and his angels fought against the dragon, and the great dragon was cast out, that old serpent called the devil and Satan, which deceiveth the whole world. He was cast out into the earth, and his angels were cast out with him. In the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. And the earth was without form and void. And darkness was upon the face of the deep. And the Spirit of God moved upon the face of the waters.
quam Lucifer, qui nescit ocasum, Christus filius tuus, qui regressus ab inferis, humano generis serenus illuxit, et tecum vivit et regnat in saecula saeculorum.
Again the devil took him to a very high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world and their splendor. All this I will give you if you will bow down and worship me.
If it wasn't clear to you in the first section, then let me spell it out for you as clearly as I can. The god of this world is Lucifer, who is given the name Satan when he was cast down to the earth. That's why the Lord God allowed Satan to tempt Jesus in Matthew 4:9 when he told him that he would give him all the powers of all the kingdoms of the earth if Jesus were to bow down and worship him, because it was his to give. In Isaiah 14:12, it describes how the Lord God saw into Lucifer's heart that he was full of pride and arrogance, and he wanted to be like God and elevate himself above the angels of God in heaven. Lucifer was one of God's most magnificent creations, but his pride resulted in an insurrection that happened in heaven, where he convinced a third of the angels to rebel against the Lord God, and they were all cast out of heaven. In the altar of St. Peter at St. Peter's Basilica in the Vatican that you see in front of you, it depicts angels coming through a vortex, which represents Lucifer and the fallen angels that are being birthed into this dimension, into the flesh, which we'll discuss later in the video. This explains why the Catholic clergy in the Vatican is bowing down worshiping to the altar of St. Peter, where you witness them singing in Latin to Lucifer, his flame donning his own creation. The flame is the light, meaning God's angels that he led astray in the rebellion and brought here to the earth to start the flesh system. That's why you'll find the all-seeing eye of Lucifer symbology in secret societies such as the Freemasons and the Illuminati, and in architecture and artwork of the Catholic Church, and even on the dollar bill, and why the global elite within Hollywood and the entertainment industry are all photographed making the same all-seeing eye hand gesture. Because Satan has recruited or taken control over the most powerful people in these organizations so that he can maintain control over humanity. I hope you're really starting to understand why Jesus says in John 15, do not love the world or anything in it. Because if you really read the Bible, throughout the Bible, it consistently says that the flesh is in opposition to the spirit. The reason why I included the clips of the sun, moon, and the stars, and the waters below the waters, and the firmament above that divides the waters above the firmament, is because I wanted you to understand that the earth is more of a focal point in the universe than just some insignificant accident that resulted from the Big Bang that's barreling through space at 1,000 miles per hour and spinning around the sun at 67,000 miles per hour, that we've been told by these lying NASA scientists that continue to perpetuate the lies with their fake trips to space. And this guy with the United States Marine Corps shirt to the right is pulling on his harness to stabilize the guy. And this woman in the back has enough hairspray in her hair to poke someone's eye out. And they're all laughing at us. The Lord God created this system called the earth for a purpose, because he knew there would be an insurrection in heaven and that Lucifer would lead a third of the angels into rebellion, forcing him to discipline them by casting them out. The earth was created as a type of purgatory to give all the angels who rebelled against the Lord God that were cast down to heaven as a second chance to come to repentance and return back to him. That's why he came in the flesh in the form of Jesus to die for our sins as payment for our transgression and our sins, so that all those who come to repentance can be redeemed. It's the greatest love story of all times. And this system is part of the Lord God's master plan to separate the good from the evil, the sheep from the goats, the wheat from the tares, before Jesus returns to burn it all and make all things new.
Let both grow together until the harvest. And in the time of harvest, I will say to the reapers, gather ye together first the tares, and bind them in bundles to burn them, but gather the wheat into my barn.
By the end of this video, you will know exactly who the wheat and the tares are, and that the separation has begun, and Jesus is coming for his wheat to store us in the barn while he judges the tares and burns them all. Earlier in the video, I stated that Satan, who is the prince of the power of the air, dwells within the children of disobedience, and you can see how his spirit has manifested throughout the world in architecture, art, movies, commercials, and in every form of media. So if this statement is true, then we should be able to find evidence of his spirit that has been manifest in the world, unless you have the spiritual blindness that the Lord has not removed yet. The Bible explains how Lucifer has taken many forms throughout history. He's been described as an angel of light, a dragon, a serpent that deceived Eve in the Garden of Eden, and a devil who Hollywood has portrayed as a horned beast. But regardless of what form he has taken over the years, his spirit has remained the same, and we should be able to find evidence of how his spirit has influenced humanity throughout the world. I explained early in the video how Satan wanted to be like the Lord God. He wanted to be worshipped like God. So if you were the God of this world and you wanted to be worshipped by everybody, you would probably start by taking control of the leadership within all religions. The Roman Catholic Church is one of the largest Christian churches in the world, which boasts of over 2.99 billion members worldwide, and even operates as a state within its states, owning its own government and financial system and laws. Vatican City is home to some of the most elaborate architecture and artwork found throughout the world. St. Peter's Basilica in Vatican City is the most popular tourist attraction, which attracts over 5 million tourists each year. As you can see, the architecture is something to be marveled, and it's even more impressive in person. In the remainder of the video, we're going to analyze the architecture and the artwork, both inside and outside of the Vatican, so that I can demonstrate to you how Satan, who is the prince of the power of the air, has influenced the minds of the architects, the builders, and the artists to create the design of the buildings, the altars, the statues, and the artwork, both inside and outside the Vatican, to communicate that he is the God of this world. But unfortunately, 99% of the population is too spiritually blind to see what is hidden in plain sight. Before we get started, I want to give all glory to the Lord God for giving me the spiritual eyes to see what he is revealing to the world through myself, and especially through Jonathan Kleck, where most of these images you're about to see came from. I found Jonathan Kleck's ministry called This Is It Before the Fire just after receiving my new spirit in Christ, and I received a supernatural dream from the Lord. You can watch my testimony if you're interested.
And there was war in heaven. Michael and his angels fought against the dragon, and the dragon fought and his angels and prevailed not, neither was their place found any more in heaven. And the great dragon was cast out, that old serpent called the devil and Satan, which deceiveth the whole world. He was cast out into the earth, and his angels were cast out with him. And I heard a loud voice saying in heaven, Now is come salvation and strength, and the kingdom of our God and the power of his Christ. For the accuser of our brethren is cast down, which accused them before our God day and night.
I hope you understand what was just revealed to you. The architecture of St. Peter's Basilica, which claims to be the largest Christian church in the world, is designed in the shape of a dragon one way, and when viewed in the opposite direction, is designed in the way of a serpent. And inside audience hall, where the Pope sometimes hosts his services, he stands in the mouth of another serpent, speaking as though he was the voice for Satan. And on the outside of St. Peter's Basilica, at the entrance to the serpent mouth, is a window to the altar of St. Peter that depicts angels coming through a vortex, representing Lucifer and the fallen angels being birthed into the flesh. Don't believe me? Let's take a closer look at the altar. In Genesis 1 verse 26, it says, And God said, Let us make man in our image. Anyone who has ever attended church has been taught that this is the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit making man in the image of God. And then in Genesis 1 verse 27, it goes on to say, So God created man in his own image. In the image of God created he him. Male and female created he them. I'm going to prove to you in this next section that this is not the Lord God creating man in his image. This is actually Lucifer and the fallen angels creating he, him, male and female, creating he, them. And this is represented in this very altar. When we take a closer look at this altar and we use the spiritual eyes that the Lord has given us when we received our new spirit in Christ, we can see that the altar is actually the male and female reproductive system described in Genesis 1.27, and the altar also makes up a big dead sheep, as you can see here right in front of you. Let's listen to Jonathan Kleck go into detail and dissect the individual scriptures to prove out Genesis 1.26, Genesis 1.27 is represented in this very altar.
See that square right there? That's the mouth of the serpent. It's that square right there. But they built in that square a bunch of angels. And because I have the gift of discernment, I can show you that's a sheep. There's the eye of the sheep. There's the eye of the sheep. Nostril, nostril. Teeth, tongue sticking out. There's the ears of the sheep. And all these angels right here are melting into what looks like honey to you. But because I know the Bible very well and the Word of God dwells in me very richly, I can show you exactly what that is, which I'll do at this particular moment. That's Genesis chapter 1, verse 2. Genesis 1, and God created the heaven and the earth, and the earth was without form and void, and darkness was upon the face of the deep, and the Spirit, the word is ruach, it means wind, breath, the Spirit of God, the word is not the Lord God, the Lord God is the head of everybody, the Lord God. But this is not the Lord God. This is God. This is Lucifer and apostate angels that lured God's children into this system and said, we can give you a host body. We can give you what you want. You can have sex. All you have to do is come with us, which is what they did. Here you go. And the Spirit of Elohim, the word Elohim is gods. It's plural. Hebrew word, 430. The word is, it says plural right there. It means gods. It means of the Supreme God. If something is of the Supreme God, it cannot be the Supreme God by definition. It is of the Supreme God. They are gods. They are of the Supreme God. They are magistrates and angels. So gods are magistrates. Magistrates are angels. And the Spirit of Elohim moved upon the face as the part that turns of the waters semen. There you go. So now I can show you that this image right here that you're looking at in the Vatican right here, the mouth of the serpent, is actually a sheep. And I'm going to zoom out now, and I've cropped the window out of it. And there it is, cropped and made easy for you to see. There's a sheep right here. There's the sheep that's the altar, and there's an actual sheep below it. Now, my question to the witness is, are you telling me that that is not a sheep? My question to the witness is that a sheep, yes or no? If your answer is no, let me tell you what Jesus said about you. So, the answer is, yes, it is a sheep. I can clearly see it's a sheep. I know it's a sheep because my ability to observe is quite acute. And I can tell you that the artist that made the altar made it in the shape of a sheep. And that the angels themselves make the wool of the sheep, and that those angels, the way the artist did the artwork, those angels are melting into what looks like honey. However, because I know the Bible and the Word of God dwells in me, I can tell you that the spirit of angels moved over the semen. And that's why I can show you quite clearly that the altar that you're looking at is not just a penis ejaculating, it is also the female reproductive system, which again is in Genesis 1. And the spirit of Elohim moved over the semen, and in Genesis 1:27, and Elohim, a bunch of gods, angels, and magistrates, said, let us make man in our vain show, representative figure, especially an idol. Therefore, the human host body is nothing more than a representative figure, especially an idol, made by Lucifer and apostate angels that left heaven and wanted to do their own thing. There you go. So, and Elohim created man in his own image, vain show, representative figure, especially an idol. In the vain show of Elohim, created he him. See the word him? The reason the word him is used is because that's Lucifer creating himself in this image. It's a spirit that's taking form, that took many other spirits with him, as in control over all that energy that left with him, because they gave themselves over to it, or they were kicked out with it. In the image of Elohim created he him. That's Lucifer creating himself. Male and female created he them. So this is where the two-party system began, and this is where Lucifer took a bunch of angels that were one thing, because angels in heaven are neither male nor female. He brought them to a system and he divided them. Male and female created he him, himself. Male and female created he them. Let me show an altar that proves that, because now we're looking at a guy singing inside of a big snake, which represents Lucifer. So they're in a building that's a big snake wearing a crown, and they're singing in front of a big dead sheep that's made up of a bunch of Elohim, God's angels and magistrates. And those Elohim are actually melting into semen, which is exactly what Genesis 1 verse 2 says. The spirit of Elohim, angels, moved over the semen. Isn't it perfect that they built a big altar of angels melting into semen? Let me show you that. So here we go. So let me move this, and let me zoom in on what I'm talking about. There you go. There's your angels right here, and there they are melting. And because it's colored gold, for your perception, it probably looks like, oh, that's a bunch of angels, and that pixelate, there it is. So here's all the angels up here, and then they're starting to melt, and this looks like honey running down the side, and that's why I can easily discern that that chair is more than a chair. That's meant to represent a penis, and the crown that the two angels are holding represent a seed coming out of the penis. And this opening right here, all you have to do is turn it upside down, and the entire thing turns into the female reproductive system. Again, that's biblically understood. If you don't understand the Bible, you'll never understand the truth, because the Bible is the truth. The Bible says, though, in Isaiah 29, 15 and 16, those who try and hide their plans from the Lord are doomed. They carry out their schemes in secret and think no one will see them or know what they are doing. They turn everything upside down. Well, let's turn it upside down and we'll see who they are. So we have all these angels melting into semen. This becomes a penis ejaculating a seed. And these are angels that are melting into semen. But when you simply turn that entire thing upside down, it becomes the female reproductive system. And here it is. I very simply just outlined the mitre hats that these two guys are wearing. I followed the lines of the artist. And there's a ovary, fallopian tube, cervix, uterus, clitoris, and opening to the vagina, and all these angels turn into pubic hair. And I've gone ahead and I've taken the female reproductive system right here, and I will slide that altar right on top to show you it's identical. There you go. Now let's talk about delusional. Now I just showed you and I presented evidence to prove that that altar is indeed the female reproductive system. So as a witness, I'm asking you, is that the female reproductive system? Yes or no? Your answer cannot be, well, you can make it whatever you want. That's not a rational argument. Okay, so let's move on then. So, yes or no? Is this the female reproductive system? Well, here is the female reproductive system. There's an ovary. There's a fallopian tube. There's an ovary. There's a fallopian tube. There's a uterus, cervix. Here's the clitoris, and here's the opening to the vagina. This model right here lacks a lot of pubic hair, like this altar does, but all you have to do is simply slide it over and you have a perfect match. So the Bible says, in the beginning, Elohim said, let us create man in our own image. In the image of Elohim created he him. Male and female created he them. So now we just simply go to that altar, which is inside of a big snake. I'll take an anatomical drawing of a penis and slide it right up there where the altar is and where the chair is, and you can easily see that the chair is built in the shape of a penis ejaculating a seed into a vagina. And when I simply turn that altar upside down, it becomes male and female. So one way it's male, there it is, male. The other way it's female, and I will simply slide it over. I will enlarge the female reproductive system, and I will slide the altar over right on top of it, and I've colored it a little bit pink to make it obvious for your perception, and there you go. Okay, so now, is it arguable? Is anyone trying to tell Jonathan Kleck that is not a big snake wearing a crown, that the mouth of the snake is not a vagina, and that there's not a penis ejaculating a seed into that vagina? And that is a bunch of people worshiping Lucifer openly, singing in Latin. Does anyone want to argue with me? If you do, you're delusional. So the Bible is absolute truth, and those that wish to come against it, you're just proving your own delusion. That's why the Bible says, anyone that loves and lives a lie goes into the pit. And unless you're born again, you will not see the kingdom of heaven. Because when you're born and you're walking around in this world, the spirit that's in you is the prince of the power of the air. Let me prove that to you. And that's why you have to be born again. So I know my Bible, the word dwells richly in me. And so I can share it with you very easily. And you he hath quickened. So those of us that have been quickened, made alive again, who were dead in your trespasses and sins, wherein in times past you walked according to the course of this world, according to the prince of the power of the air. I highlighted it all in yellow. That is Satan. Satan is the name given to Lucifer after the fall. He's called the accuser of the brethren. Now, the prince of the power of the air is Satan. Think of a radio station, because that's how he operates. He operates through everyone, just like a radio station. The prince of the power of the air, the spirit that worketh in the children of disobedience. Let me show you what the word spirit is. The word spirit is Greek word 4151. The word is pneuma, like pneumonia. It means a current of air that is a breath. Okay, it also means the rational soul. I'm going to highlight that for y'all right there. The rational soul. I'll make it a very different color. There it is. The rational soul. It means superhuman, in parentheses, an angel, comma, demon, or divine Christ spirit. Well, Jesus said, unless you're born again, you will not see the kingdom of heaven, because you're born with a superhuman angel demon that's in opposition to each other. So you're your own worst enemy. Unless you get born again and you get divine God Christ spirit, you will go into the pit. That's made very obvious in the Bible by Ephesians 2. It says right here, wherein in times past you walked according to the course of this world, according to the prince of the power of the air, the spirit that works in the children of disobedience. The word spirit is little s. Right here in John chapter 3, Jesus said, verily I say unto you, except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of heaven. See, he cannot see the kingdom of God. I'm sorry, not the kingdom of heaven, the kingdom of God. And the reason is because once you're born again, you can see the kingdom of God, just as I've shown you. I'm showing you that the largest church in the world is really a big snake wearing a crown. I'm showing you the largest altar in the world is really a penis, a vagina, and it's a dead sheep and a bunch of angels melting into semen, which is exactly what Genesis 1 verse 2 says. The spirit of Elohim, angels, moved over the semen. So they built a big altar delineating exactly what's in Genesis 1 verse 2. Does anybody have any trouble understanding what I'm saying? And if you do have trouble understanding what I'm saying, let me go to the Bible and show you the reason you do have trouble understanding what I'm saying. Matthew. Okay, Jesus spoke in parables. And he said, and the disciples came and said unto him, why do you speak to them in parables? And he said, because it is given unto you to know the mysteries of the kingdom of heaven, but to them it is not given. So again, the Bible is absolute truth. I have a biblical worldview, not a secular worldview. I don't base anything off a secular worldview. My entire worldview is based out of the Bible. So Jesus said, to me it has been given to understand the mysteries of the kingdom of heaven. To them, it has not been given. So the reason they call me delusional is because they have not been given the ability to understand the mysteries of the kingdom of heaven, because they were never born again. Just like Jesus said, unless you're born again, you will not see the kingdom of heaven. Then he said, unless you're born again, except a man be born of water. And look, the word spirit has changed from Ephesians 2. Ephesians 2 said, when you walked according to the prince of the power there, the spirit, the word is little s, spirit, and we're going to go look it up, and we're going to look at the Greek word so we know exactly what it is. The prince of the power there is the word spirit, and it means a superhuman angel demon or divine God Christ spirit. Well, we know it's not divine God Christ spirit, because that's what you get when you get born again. So by default, you are a superhuman angel demon. Then you get born again and you get divine God Christ spirit. That's why when you go to John chapter 3, and Jesus says, unless you're born again, verily I say unto you, except a man be born of water and the Spirit, the word Spirit right here is capitalized, but it's the same exact word. I'll click on it. See, that means you got born of Christ's Spirit. So now, by simple logic and obvious reasoning, I have proven that you're born with a superhuman angel demon, and then you have to be born again of Christ's Spirit in order to see the kingdom of God and to enter heaven. Does anybody want to argue with the logic I just showed you? You do? Well, Jesus said something about those that wish to argue with it. Here's what he said. He said, for you it is given to understand the mysteries of the kingdom of heaven, but to them it is not given. For whoever hath, to him shall be given, and he shall have more and in abundance. But whoever hath not, from him shall be taken away even that which he hath. Therefore I speak to them in parables, because they seeing, see not, and they hearing, hear not. Neither do they understand. So Jesus is saying, and being very obvious, that my adversaries, they cannot see and they cannot hear, neither can they understand. However, I can, because it's been given to me to understand the mysteries of the kingdom of heaven, because I've been born of the Spirit of Christ instead of a superhuman angel demon. Is there any flaw in my logic? Is there any flaw in the Word of God that I just showed you? The answer is no. And if you argue with me, you're delusional. What does delusional mean? Delusional means you're holding an idiosyncratic belief or impression that is contradicted by reality or rational argument. All I'm doing is presenting reality and rational argument to show anyone that would come against me, you're delusional. And you know what the Bible said? Because you had pleasure in unrighteousness and you had not the love of the truth, God himself is going to send you strong delusion. So God is making you delusional. He won't let you believe the truth. You know why? Because you don't have the love of the truth in you. And if you don't, then you get to be delusional. Perfect. Again, perfection. We see clearly, and the Spirit of truth lives in us. And Jesus said, you'll know the truth, and the truth will set you free. By the way, Jesus is the truth. You'll know Jesus, and Jesus will set you free. Jesus said, I am the way, I am the truth, I am the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. So unless you know the truth, you don't know anything, do you? By definition. Truth is when facts equal reality, and all I'm showing you are facts. That's all I'm showing you.
You just bared witness to Jonathan Kleck using the altar of St. Peter and the Bible in Genesis 1:26 and 27 to prove that Lucifer created himself both male and female, then created man male and female. And in every human being there is an angel and a demon spirit until we are reborn with the Spirit of Christ. In this next section, I'm going to apply my spiritual gift that the Lord God gave to me to reveal to you the hidden imagery of the artwork that you see in front of you of the papal symbol in the Vatican Museum and prove to you that this artwork represents the all-seeing eye of Lucifer. I'm also going to show you how Lucifer, or Satan, who is also given the name Apollyon or Abaddon, the angel from the bottomless pit who rules over the scorpion race that will be birthed out in the end times, described in Revelation 9:11, was able to birth his spirit into every human host body that has ever been born on earth. This is truly a revelation from the Lord God. If he didn't have the spiritual eyes to see, or if he didn't know the system that we live in, then there's no way the common person visiting the Vatican would understand what they're looking at here. So let's break down the individual images within this artwork and apply Genesis 1:27 to this. So Elohim created man in his own image. In the image of Elohim created he him, male and female. So let's go through and analyze this artwork image by image. On the left side of the image, we have a male red dragon representing the male energy. On the right side, we have a female dragon represented by the blue female energy. At the top of the image, we have a beehive. Just below the beehive, we have two keys representing key locks. Below the key locks, we have what appears to be a man in a slave collar. And then in purple, we have circled an owl. Below the owl is another beehive, which seems to be in place of a head for that body. And then in the middle of the image, we have a red dragon that is circled,
right in the middle, which we'll explain a little bit later what that means. And then below the beehive, we have individual bees, which represent almost breasts on this host body. And then below that, we have a devil face. And as you can see, the cumulative sum of all these images, when outlined in the way that Jonathan Kleck has highlighted, it becomes a fallen angel. Before we analyze which each image in the artwork represents, let's do a quick biology lesson. We know that conception occurs when the male sperm penetrates the female egg and the spark of life occurs. This spark is the angelic energy inside every human being. The first stage of cell division forms a vesica piscis, which is the intersection of the male and female egg, which is when both male and female contribute 23 of their own chromosomes, totaling a 46, to the new created life. It's also the first stage in sacred geometry that we find in the Kabbalistic tree of life and the Platonic solids that make up Metatron's cube that we'll talk about later in the video. You know what's crazy is I took this image from the movie Lucy, which is short for Lucifer, and I didn't realize until I was making this video that in the middle of the vesica piscis is what appears to be a red dragon, which I believe was just a confirmation from the Lord that I was on track with the content that he wanted me to put in this video, because the next slide that you're going to see here is going to speak volumes to this image. I mean, you can't make this stuff up. So now when you overlay a vesica piscis on this artwork, that image of the dragon in the middle makes a lot more sense. You've got a male and a male dragon on the left hand side and a female dragon on the right hand side. And so when those intersection of the two seeds come together, these two humans produce another human being or host body with the spirit of the dragon, or the spirit of the prince of the power of the air, inside of that new baby, or I should say host body. So now when we apply this image to Genesis 1:27, where it says Elohim created he, him, male and female, this is a perfect representation of that scripture, because you have a male and a female dragon. That's Lucifer creating himself both male and female. Then it goes on to say created he them male and female. So whatever is produced from these two intersections of the cells, whether it be male or female, he's producing himself inside of he, them, whether it be male or female. Guys, this is the Lord revealing the mystery of all mysteries. We also see Genesis 1:27 represented in the Sistine Chapel in the artwork of Michelangelo, where you have Lucifer, both male and female, and it appears that he's being birthed into another dimension or into another level of heaven. And just below where he's being birthed, there's an angel holding up a skin suit, which is representative of Genesis 1:27, let us create man in our own image. Image is the word salam, which means a phantom, especially illusion, an idol. I mean, the scriptures are perfect with all the artwork and the architecture in the Vatican. You just can't make this stuff up. And just to prove to you that there is no doubt that the human host body is an idol, which the Lord God hates and warns humanity not to create, let's look at Exodus 20 verse 4. The Lord says, "Thou shalt not make any graven images," images translated to idol, "or any likeness of anything that is in heaven or that is on earth or beneath the earth or beneath the waters of the earth." When you look at the word likeness in the Strong's Concordance, it translates to tamau, something that is portioned out, or a shape that is a phantom, specifically embodiment. And then when you look to the root of that word from H4327, it means to portion out, that is a species. So the Lord is clearly warning us not to make a species of man, and I believe that his warning also applies to cloning in the modern day today. And to top it off, the cumulative sum of all the images in the Sistine Chapel make a dragon. I mean, look at it. And once again, we find another depiction of Genesis 1:27 at the Medici Chapel, where you have Lucifer on top making himself male and female, and below at the bottom of the statue is an owl, and there's a man on top of another skin suit, which is a phantom image, especially an illusion and an idol. We have passed the realm of coincidence. Now we have established a pattern of the same consistent theme in all these different architecture and all these different images. Now you know who the builders are that's described in the Bible as the builders who rejected the cornerstone, which is Jesus in Mark 12:10. They were the builders of this world who were influenced by the spirit of the prince of the power of the air. They are the modern day Freemasons. Albert Pike, who is a 33-degree Grand Master in the Scottish Rite Freemasonry, quoted, "Lucifer, the son of the morning, is it he who bears the light, and with all its splendor, intolerable blinds, feeble, sensual, or selfish souls? Doubt it not." Going back to the artwork of the papel in the Museum of the Vatican, we see the beehive. In Egyptian mythology, bees represent the tears from the sun god Ra, and we know from my last video the sun god Ra represents the dragon. Worship of the sun is worship of the dragon, is worship of Lucifer, is worship of the devil. The beehive symbology in this image is essentially the all-seeing eye of Lucifer. Lucifer has birthed himself into every human being, and his spirit of disobedience is working in the children of disobedience until you are saved. This is the collective consciousness. This is what you call the hive mind. This is how he is able to take captive at his will, described in 2 Timothy. Until you are converted with the spirit of Christ, you are a child of the devil. That's what the Bible says. That's why you need to be reconciled back to the Father. And this hive mind or collective consciousness symbology can be found manifesting throughout the world. In London, this Lynn Chadwick statue appears to have both a male and a female body with a pyramid on his head representing the hive mind. In Freemasonry, they also have the beehive symbology, which represents the hive mind, and it also represents the worker bees. We are the worker bees. Lucifer is the top, and his spirit is working through these global elites all the way down through the people at the bottom of the pyramid, which is you and I. We are the worker bees within the hive, and we are part of this collective consciousness unless you get converted with the spirit of Christ. Now you know why people in Hollywood and the entertainment industry and professional sports are always making that all CNI or the OK sign, because they are part of the hive mind. They are mocking us in plain sight because they know the secret. And the secret is Lucifer is the god of this world, and they have sold out for fame, fortune, and for power. And in return, they are servants of the devil. They are keeping us distracted, keeping us entertained, keeping us thinking that this is what the world is all about, and we should all strive to be like them and idol them and worship them. And in reality, they're leading us right into the pit. They're leading us right into sin. They're leading us into a culture that is contrary to the Lord God. This woman right in front of you is a perfect example of how the prince of the power of the air is working in the children of disobedience. This woman is dressed like a demon, she's dressed like a hive, and she's got a bee on her forehead. Why else would somebody dress like that if they weren't being controlled by a different spirit? This image represents this prince of the power of the air and his symbology, basically manifesting in every form of religion, including Egyptian, Catholicism, Freemasonry, Hinduism, the New Age movement, the Kabbalah, and it's even on the US dollar. The owl symbology represents Lucifer or Satan's ability to see in the dark. Owls are also birds of prey. They are predators, just like our adversary. And we know from 1 Peter 5:8 that our adversary rolls around like a roaring lion looking for our souls to devour. Now you know why all the global elites and the world leaders who go to Bohemian Grove every summer and do a cremation of care ceremony are worshiping in front of a 40-foot statue of an owl. Last but not least is the man in the slave collar in the center. This represents all of God's angels who rebelled against the Lord God and were led astray by Lucifer and were birthed into this dimension called the flesh. We are trapped in our prison suit. We are trapped until we can be redeemed by the Lord God when we die. And the host body in this image with the devil at the bottom where the penis or the vagina is represents that every seed that comes out of a man or a woman passes on the seed of the serpent, the seed of the devil, into that child. Do you know what the word womb is in the Bible? W-O-M-B. It's Hebrew word rachem, meaning matrix. Let's listen to a brief clip to see the similarities of what I've been showing you.
The matrix. Do you want to know what it is? The matrix is everywhere. It is all around us. Even now, in this very room, you can see it when you look out your window or when you turn on your television. You can feel it when you go to work, when you go to church, when you pay your taxes. It is the world that has been pulled over your eyes to blind you from the truth.
What truth?
that you are a slave, Neo. Like everyone else, you were born into bondage, born into a prison that you cannot smell or taste or touch. A prison for your mind.
The Bible says in Ephesians 5:13, everything that is hidden in the dark will be brought to light and made manifest. And Jesus said, "Awake, O sleeper, arise from the dead, and Christ will give you life." Jesus said this because what people think is life is actually death. When we decided to rebel against the Lord God in heaven and take on host bodies when we were birthed into this dimension, which is the flesh, our spiritual energy or our soul became locked in our flesh, which is our mental prison, because Satan has created a false reality in this world to blind everyone from the truth. That's why you see a man in a slave collar depicted in the papal work in the Vatican and also on this image of the list of the popes. It should be pretty clear to you by now that the God mentioned in Genesis 1 is not the Lord God. It is Elohim. It is Lucifer and his angels that came here to start this system. So let's look in Genesis 1:28 where it says, "And God blessed them, and God said, go on and be fruitful and multiply and replenish the earth and subdue it." Again, when we go back to the Strong's Concordance and we look up the word blessed, H1288, we see that this has a whole new meaning when you look at it from the Elohim perspective. If we were talking about the Lord God, then the word blessed, meaning Barak, would be an act of adoration. But since we are talking about Elohim, it translates to use man as a benefit, meaning to curse God or the king as treason, blasphemy. So we know that the Lord God warned us in Exodus 20 verse 4 not to make any graven image or a species of man, and that could be categorized as treason or blasphemy against the Lord God. So the question then is how would man be used as a benefit to Elohim when Elohim blessed them and said, "Be fruitful and multiply and replenish the earth"? To answer this question, we need to go back to Genesis 2 when Elohim rested from their creation. In Genesis 2 verse 1, it states, "Thus the heavens and the earth were finished, and all the hosts of them." When we trace the word host back through the Strong's Concordance to the original Hebrew text, we get the word sabah. Sabah means a mass of persons, especially organized for war, an army, by implication, a campaign. And when we look at the root of that word, H6633, it means to mass, an army of servants, assemble, fight, perform, muster, wait upon war. So from this description, it appears that Elohim, Lucifer, and his angels are expecting war against the Lord God. And this makes perfect sense because we know in Isaiah 14 that the Lord God saw into Lucifer's heart that he wanted to be like God. He wanted to seat his throne above the angels of God. So if Lucifer was preparing to go to war with the Lord God, he would have to muster or prepare a super angelic demonic army to be a worthy adversary against the legion of God's angels in heaven, right? Because humans made of flesh would just get crushed. And when we read Revelation 9, when the fifth angel sounds, a star or an angel falls from heaven and is given the keys to the bottomless pit. And out of the pit flies what's described as a demonic scorpion locust race that gives us a clue of what Satan's army is going to look like in the end times.
And the fifth angel sounded, and I saw a star fall from heaven unto the earth, and to him was given the key of the bottomless pit. And he opened the bottomless pit, and there arose a smoke out of the pit, as the smoke of a great furnace. And the sun and the air were darkened by reason of the smoke of the pit. And there came out of the smoke locusts upon the earth, and unto them was given power, as the scorpions of the earth have power. And it was commanded them that they should not hurt the grass of the earth, neither any green thing, neither any tree, but only those men which have not the seal of God in their foreheads. And to them it was given that they should not kill them, but that they should be tormented 5 months. And their torment was as the torment of a scorpion when he striketh a man. And in those days shall men seek death, and shall not find it, and shall desire to die, and death shall flee from them. And the shapes of the locusts were like unto horses prepared unto battle, and on their heads were, as it were, crowns like gold,
and their faces were as the faces of men. And they had hair as the hair of women, and their teeth were as the teeth of lions. And they had breastplates, as it were, breastplates of iron. And the sound of their wings was as the sound of chariots of many horses running to battle. And they had tails like unto scorpions, and there were stings in their tails. And their power was to hurt men 5 months. And they had a king over them, which is the angel of the bottomless pit, whose name in the Hebrew tongue is Abaddon, but in the Greek tongue hath his name Apollyon.
In this next section, I'm going to prove to you by using the scriptures and through visual evidence from the artwork in the Vatican, the horrifying truth about the human race, that the human host body is being used as a transmutation device to convert God's angels that were led astray from heaven by Lucifer and birthed into this flesh, which is us, into a demonic scorpion race of beings that will be birthed out in the end times to war against the Lord God and all that was created by Elohim. Sounds pretty crazy, right? Well, let's listen to Ezekiel 13, 20 through 21, and then we're going to have Jonathan Kleck dissect what the scripture is actually saying.
Wherefore thus saith the Lord God, behold, I am against your pillows, wherewith ye there hunt the souls to make them fly. And I will tear them from your arms, and will let the souls go, even the souls that ye hunt to make them fly. Your kerchiefs also will I tear, and deliver my people out of your hand, and they shall be no more in your hand to be hunted, and ye shall know that I am the Lord.
So, here's a question for you. True or not true, every single child that's ever been on this thing you call the earth, since the time of Christ, if it's not born again of a new spirit, it goes to the pit, yes or no? If you've been born, and I'm not talking about children that are not of the age of reason, I'm talking that if you're born and you grow up and you become an adolescent adult and you die and you're not born again, do you go to hell? Yes, the answer is absolutely yes. So the only way to go back to heaven, to be reconciled, see the word reconciled, the Bible says, God was in Christ reconciling the world back to himself. Reconciliation happens when there's been a relationship that's been broken. By definition, that's what reconciliation is. You can't be reconciled to someone that you weren't already, you know, tight with. But there was a breach of friendship or intimacy, and then you have to be reconciled, brought back together. So, that means since the time of Christ, since the New Testament, everyone that's ever lived, if you're not born again, then you go to the pit. I wonder who benefits from that. Well, what's down in the pit? Just stop and do the math. So let's take a look at their system again. So just in case anyone didn't believe me, see, wherein in times past, like before you got saved, you walked according to the course of this world, according to the prince of the power of the air, the spirit, the superhuman angel demon that worketh in the children of disobedience, among whom also we all had our conversation in the past in the lusts of our flesh. See, because the lusts of the flesh is what gets you there, and fulfilling the desires of the flesh and the mind, and we were by nature the children of wrath, even as the others. But God, who is rich in mercy, for his great love wherewith he loved us, even we were dead in sins, hath quickened us together with Christ by grace. So see, you get quickened by being joined together with Christ and made whole, because there's a good you and there's a bad you. There's a double you. That's why they like the letter W so much, because they're mocking the crap out of you. Okay, so now let's see this girl, Hunter in Training. Let's take a little look at her shirt. Hunter in Training. So it shows like the sun, because it's gonna be the fuel system. She's the hunter, and what's she hunting? A star. Well, do you know what a star is? It's one of God's angels. We are referred to in the Bible as stars. Those who are wise in Daniel 12, those who are wise in the end will shine like the stars in the firmament. It says princes. Oh, look at this. Shadow hunter. Nice. Because, let's see, here's a good example of why this girl that's wearing a shirt that says shadow hunter, because what's really hunting this guy is an insect from the pit. Now, if you don't believe me, let me just show you the Bible real quick. Let me show you a really cool scripture. Okay, so remember I told you there's like a Bluetooth line from you, the one that's pointing down, that goes down to the pit, like just picture a wasp nest, and a little like octagon or hexagon that's got a little white pillow on top where your doppelganger has one eye and sees everything you do and everywhere you go. And that doppelganger has a leader over them, which is the angel of the bottomless pit, which is Satan. And all the little doppelgangers see every human where they go, unless they get converted, then you cut the line. So if you're this and you get converted, boom, you cut the line and you get turned up. They no longer have hold on you, and you kill the demon inside. So look at this. Thus saith the Lord God, behold, I am against your pillows, a pillow as a covering for a seat or a bed. Look, watch this, to fill up hollows, you know, like a grub in a wasp nest, by implication to cover for clothing or secrecy, to clad self, conceal, cover self. Now watch this, just like the little grubs in a wasp nest, to be covered with flesh, to grow fat, that is to be covered with flesh. So, I am against your pillows wherewith ye hunt the souls to make them fly. I mean, there it is, guys. You're looking at it. Whereby, wherewith ye, there ye hunt the souls to make them fly. Even the souls that ye hunt to make them fly. Your kerchiefs I will tear and deliver my people out of your hand, and they shall be no more in the hand in your hand to be hunted. Okay, what's hunting them? Just like the shadow of the girl. It's a bug from the pit, because locusts are coming out of the pit. This is the above ground hunters. That's the race that's hunting us. Just like the clothing line. Hunted for dinner. There you go. See, look. There you go. Exactly what I'm talking about. See? There they are to fill up the hollows. See, there's the hollow. There's the pillow. And just picture a Bluetooth line from a host body. The Bluetooth line that's down, that goes down to one of those in the pit. That's why when they baptize a little baby in the Catholic Church, they're consecrating it to its evil freaking doppelganger. Just like CERN. CERN is the same thing. I mean, it's, you know, just in the imagery. But when CERN opens up, all that stuff comes out. Because CERN is being used by the angel of the bottomless pit running the little host body system to open up the pit. You getting this? Yeah. It's pretty intense, right? So I'm against your pillows right there. And then what does it mean? I'm against your pillows right there, pillows. A pillow as a covering or a seat or bed. Let's look at the picture. See, right there, pillow. Let's go back to the Bible. It says, wherewith you hunt the souls. Well, let's expand on the word pillow. A cushion is a pillow covering a seat or bed, because that's how the little baby got there from being in the bed with the girl that's hunting him. Fill up hollows. By implication, to cover for clothing or secrecy. You would never think that you're really a host body for a bug down in the pit, would you? You don't find out till you die. Unless, of course, you sought it out with your entire heart like I did. I was like, I just want to know the truth. Nothing on this world makes sense anymore. So the Lord led me to it. But I was already predestined for it, you know what I mean? So anyway, the Lord had me predestined for this. So anyway, so there it is. Look, see, fill up hollows. By implication, to cover for clothing or secrecy, clad self, conceal, cover self. Yeah, that's pretty crazy. lick it to fill up the hollow. There's the pillow. And then this little thing is attached to an above ground human host body. Do you get it? That's why when the pit opens, boom, I would imagine that the doppelganger that's in the pit probably, it would just seem like it would seek you out like a Bluetooth, you know, just like we could find our cell phone. I don't know. But if you've been cut from that, if the pit opens and they come out, I don't think they can touch you, because the Bible says they can't touch, they can sting only those men that have not the seal of God. So if you've got the seal of God, you don't have to anything to worry about.
Guys, I don't know if you were able to comprehend what was just revealed to you, but there's your scriptural proof that the angelic energy inside every human host body, which is our soul, is being hunted by this serpent race to birth another race of demonic scorpion locusts from the pit. And Satan, who is Abaddon or Apollyon, is using sin as a method to keep us connected to that Bluetooth or frequency of the prince of the power of the air, the spirit that works within the children of disobedience, because it's sin that separates us from the Lord God. And the Bible even says in Ezekiel 2 verse 6 that we dwell among scorpions. Are you starting to get this? Now the bee symbology that we analyze in the Pipo Rogel artwork in the Vatican Museum, and also the beehive symbology we saw in the Freemason imagery, is starting to make a lot more sense, doesn't it? Because the bees represent the below ground race, and how Satan is able to see into every host body represented by the all-seeing eye of Lucifer. Bees not only communicate through pheromones, but they also communicate through vibrational frequencies, very much how the human host body is connected to the hive mind through the spirit of the prince of the power of the air, through his frequencies, which we'll talk later in the video. So if Jonathan Kleck was able to find visual evidence in the altar of St. Peter to support what the scriptures say in Genesis 1:26 and Genesis 1:27, that the human race started as a result of Elohim, Lucifer and his angels, leading God's angels astray from heaven into the system, which is the flesh, where Lucifer created himself male and female, and then created everyone else male and female, then we should be able to also identify visual evidence to support Ezekiel 13 that describes how human souls are being hunted to birth this other race of beings from the pit. Let's have Jonathan do another quick recap, and let's look at this altar from a different vantage point so I can show you where these images of the transmutation process is hidden in plain sight in this very same altar.
Here is the penis. There is the penis. There, they have these candles that make a vesica. See them? There's five here and five here. Isn't that perfect? And then there's a crown coming out representing the seed. Well, when you look from above, all the angels look like a bunch of honey or syrup. Just look at the movement. I'm an artist. Look at the movement. It's all flowing downward. This is a flow. This is a flow, as in flowing out of where this light is, and it's flowing downward, see? And look at it. As it hits, look how it goes back and forth on both sides of the penis. Oh, wow. And the spirit of Elohim, God's angels, magistrates, moved over the semen. There it is. So now you know why the Lord God gave me this revelation gift. Because I'm using the gift to prove the scriptures that the Lord is revealing to me are true. I mean, you know, a lot of people, oh, that's impossible. No, wrong. I looked up the definition of the word, and then I have a supernatural gift that proves it's true. And we're admitting this to the court record right now, because when the Lord comes, the truth is what convicts everybody, all those that didn't accept the truth. Jesus is the truth, okay?
So the truth about the flesh system that we are all trapped in, represented by the man in the slave collar that we watched earlier, should resemble an angel to scorpion race transmutation process. And this process should include angels coming through a vortex, which are moving on the face of the semen that Jonathan just showed us. It should also include an image of a man, which resembles a host body. It should also include a larva or a worm, which is the pupa stage of this race being birthed, which is also our evil doppelganger that we are connected to the pit, an image of this new scorpion race, and an image of something resembles this entire transmutation process, and also something that is symbolic of a hive.
Similar to how the Lord instructed Jonathan to look down at the altar from a different vantage point to see that these angels were actually melting into semen, he also instructed me to take a closer look at the images within the angels that were melting. And when I did, he revealed the entire system right in front of us. The image of the face in front of you represents Genesis 1:2, where it says, "And Elohim moved upon the face of the waters." This represents man being birthed into this dimension and is the moment where a host body was created. The next image that the Lord led me to is the lava or the worm, which is the pupa stage of this new race being born in the hollows that are covered up with the pillows that the Lord is against, described in Ezekiel 13:21, which also is our evil doppelganger that we are connected to in the pit. I would have never found this image if it wasn't for the Lord working through my son, because one evening my son would just kept bugging me to watch the movie Godzilla. And like within the first 10 minutes of the movie, they were showing Mothra in the pupa form, which shows you this worm right in front of you. And if I hadn't had that image in my mind from the night before, I would have never seen that image in the altar when I was looking at it the next day. I mean, it was supernatural, and I knew that that was the Lord just leading me to this image. The next image you see in the altar is a spider, and I did my best to draw in the lines in the image to give you some perspective, but it almost looks like a spider taken out of the movie Harry Potter. When I looked up spider symbology, the spider symbology means the shadow of yourself or the dark aspects of your personality. The other symbolic meaning of the spider is patience, as it's patiently waiting for the perfect timing to catch its prey. I mean, this is exactly what Jonathan Kleck has been showing in his videos about the cannibalism system, that there's one race hunting another. And it's also demonstrated in the Maserati commercial that he's been showing, that they come out of the dark and strike when we're not expecting it. It's crazy. The next image in this altar is an image of a skull, which represents death, because part of the transmutation process is going from man to scorpion. And when we die in our sin, our soul becomes fuel for that scorpion race that's in the pit. So that's represented right here by the skull. And now for the image that we've all been waiting for. Look in front of you and check out what this scorpion looks like. It's got teeth like lion, tails like scorpions, and a big wing that it's going to sound like chariots of horses running into battle when these things fly out of the pit. I do not want to be here when these things come out of that pit. If this image is any indication of what these things actually look like when they come out of the pit, it's going to be horrifying for those who don't have the seal of God in them. And finally, to find an image that resembles the larger hive, all we need to do is look at the monument of Alexander and also look up at the ceiling of the altar of St. Peter. And in front of you, it clearly represents a honeycomb. Guys, I know this can be overwhelming data to absorb because it's going to challenge everything that you believe to be the truth about this world. And when that happens, there's a natural defense mechanism to reject this information. But I want you to just stop and think about what you just witnessed from a scriptural perspective, and also all the images that you just witnessed in the Vatican about this entire transmutation process. Now take a look at this image in front of you that was created by Michelangelo and ask yourself a question. Why would the artist that created this statue create a piece of artwork that has a grub or a worm or a larva coming out of what appears to be the head of a body, if the information that I didn't share with you wasn't true? And if that doesn't seal the deal for you, let's take a step back from that altar and look at it from a distance. And when you trace in the line of the architecture of the altar of St. Peter, it becomes a big bug harvesting semen from that big penis in the altar. Now you know why the Bible says no fornicators nor adulterers will enter the kingdom of heaven, because you don't know what you're fornicating with. Let's listen to Jonathan Kleck prove out this transmutation process from dissecting some images on the list of popes in the Vatican. The image you see in front of you is from the list of popes. Anyone who has ever been pope gets their name printed on this, I don't know what you want to call it, but listen to Jonathan as he dissects this image in front of us.
Right here, my very supernatural gift the Lord gave me to share with you allows me to see exactly what it is. It's a human in a slave collar. It's really an angel that's been caught in a host body. And there's two fetuses, one here, one here. Here's the human in the slave collar. But I'm gonna take the human and put him up there so you don't see his face. That all you see is the slave collar, and the slave collar is a beast. There's the eye, there's the nose, there's the eye, nose, fang, tongue. And so the human is in the beast system. The beast system is double-minded, two different minds right there. And so one's goes to the pit, one's good, one's evil. Knowledge, tree of the knowledge of good and evil. And you're in it. So now I'm just going to color it in for you in this image right here so you can see it. You can see I've done a lot of work on this. The Lord guided me through all of it. Who do you think guided me to draw it in? Do you think I just decided to? That'd be weird. Anyway, so here's the guy in the slave collar. And if you take a very close look at these lines right here, that's an umbilical cord. So is that. I've seen one several times. Those are umbilical cords going to different fetuses. Oh, what was that Lady Gaga said? What did Lady Gaga say? Lady Gaga said, my performance is about a new race of beings, locusts, being birthed within the human race. Because just like Michelangelo's, you know, carving of the human body, missing the head with a caterpillar in it, you know, waiting to come out and get its wings. But it's going to eat you from the inside out, which is not an uncommon thing in the insect world, by the way. And so here you go. And so here in the insect world, it is not uncommon for a different variety of different insects to sting its prey and put an egg in it, and then it eats it from the inside out. I'm going to show you a tattoo of that right now in just a sec. But so when you take that guy in a slave collar and you turn it upside down, all you have to do is turn it upside down, and it becomes a locust coming out of the pit. There's the eye. There's the eye. There's the mandible. There's the mandible. And here's the all what looked like the crazy hair of the guy in the slave collar is really the movement of air under the wings, these yellow wings that are flapping while this locust is coming out of the pit. So Isaiah said, those who try and hide their plans from the Lord are doomed. This is Isaiah 29, 15, and 16. Those who try and hide their plans from the Lord are doomed. They carry out their schemes in secret and think no one will see them or know what they are doing. They turn everything upside down. Well, they turn God's angels upside down. And they got them in a host body system trap. And they're converting a human, using the human host body as a transmutation device to convert an angel to a locust from the pit. And all you have to do to see that is look right here. There. Let me go back to that one picture. So there's the human in a slave collar, the beast system, the woman that rides the beast, there it is, the female mother goddess system, human in a slave collar, beast system, turns to locust from the pit, and it's an angel that got trapped.
So we have images to support this transmutation process depicted in the altar of St. Peter. We also have images of this transmutation process on the list of popes. So let's revisit the artwork and the papal symbol in the Vatican Museum to slam this door shut on any doubt that the human host body is being used to transmute spiritual energy from one species to another. In this next section, I'm also going to share with you my personal testimony of how the Lord supernaturally revealed to me who the angel of the bottomless pit is, whose name is Abaddon or Apollyon. You know him as Satan in this very image. Once you see this, you'll know for certain that this information could only have come from the revelation of the Lord. After the Lord had revealed to me all the different images in this artwork that I spoke about earlier in the video, he kept drawing me back to this. He kept showing me that there was something more to it, and I didn't know what it was. And then one afternoon, I was watching television in my living room, and this thought came into my mind, and it said, watch Alien 3. And I was like, where did that come from? And then I said, well, Lord, if that is from you, then if I turn the station and look through the channel guide, then I gotta be able to turn to the station and have this movie be on. And sure enough, it was. And for those who doubt that we can't have a direct relationship with the Lord and the Lord doesn't speak to us, in John 10, 27 through 28, it says, my sheep hear my voice and I know them and they follow me. So I clicked on the channel and I started to watch the movie. And as soon as I saw the scene in front of you, I immediately knew what I was being shown. As the cameras zoom out, the alien eggs that are used to birth the serpent race become enclosed in a hexagon shape, which if you have eyes to see, represents a cell in a beehive, or what's described as fill-up hollows that are covered by the pillows the Lord says he is against in Ezekiel 13:21. And when we compare this image to the papal artwork in the Vatican Museum, we see the same image. I didn't include the movie footage in this video, but just picture a human being popping through that membrane in the center there, and that represents the dragon being birthed. I mean, this is absolutely perfect. And just to prove to you that the artwork in the Vatican is a depiction of this alien movie, this next image that you're going to see is going to blow your mind, and it's going to prove the accuracy of the revelation that the Lord has revealed to me.
And I saw a star fall from heaven unto the earth, and to him was given the key of the bottomless pit. And he opened the bottomless pit, and there arose a smoke out of the pit. And they had a king over them, which is the angel of the bottomless pit, whose name in the Hebrew tongue is Abaddon, but in the Greek tongue hath his name Apollyon.
I hope you understand the gravity of what you're looking at here. The Lord just revealed to us that this image in the Vatican, in the largest Christian church in the world, is Apollyon, Abaddon, the angel from the bottomless pit. Do you understand that you're looking at an image of Satan? And now I'll share with you my testimony of how this was revealed to me. About 3 weeks ago, I was watching the YouTube channel Enter the Stars, and Casey was exposing some things about Trump that Trump supporters just don't believe. In the video, Casey was describing Trump as a bad Don, like a bad Donald. And for some reason, that stuck with me over the next couple weeks. So fast forward to the day that I received the revelation that this image was actually Satan. In the past, the Lord has always given me visions by making me tired. And as I'm laying down just before I fall asleep, I get a flash vision in my mind. And that usually gives me an indication of what he's revealing to me. Well, that day it happened the same way. I was laying down because I had gotten tired and I started to fall asleep. Sleep listening to a video, and the video must have ended because it switched to a news report with Donald Trump speaking. And in my spirit, I heard Abaddon, and then all of a sudden I got the flash vision of this predator animal, and I knew right then and there that the Lord was revealing to me who the identity of this character was. Because earlier in the week I had been praying to the Lord and asking him, is this really Abaddon?
And there came out of the smoke locusts, and their teeth were as the teeth of lions. And they had a king over them, which is the angel of the bottomless pit, whose name in the Hebrew tongue is Abaddon, but in the Greek tongue hath his name Apollyon.
After I had received this vision from the Lord, I went back and watched all three Predator movies. And in every movie, they describe who this character is, who this demon is. This creature is described as El Diablo, which is Spanish for devil. In Predator 2, he's described as the Prince of the Power, which we know that Satan is the Prince of the Power of the Air. And in Predator, he's described as the demon that makes trophies of men. You know what a definition of a trophy is? Something gained or given in victory or conquest, especially when preserved as a monument or memorial. So tell me what's different from this trophy room of skulls in the Roman Catholic Church, from this trophy wall of skulls in Predator 2. Is this other race in the pit publicly proclaiming victory over man?
And they use us like cattle. We're hosts for them to breed in. This whole thing was a trap.
Did you hear that? It was a trap. It was a trap set by Lucifer to lead all of God's angels astray and away from the Lord God in heaven. And when we read 2 Timothy 2:24 and 25, we understand what that whole trap was all about. 2 Timothy 2 says, "And the servant of the Lord must not strive, but be gentle unto all men, and to teach patiently in meekness, instructing those who impose themselves. If God will give them repentance to acknowledging the truth, that they may recover themselves out of the snare of the devil, who can take them captive at his will." And that trap or snare is exactly what you see depicted in this guy with a slave collar that we find on the list of popes in the Vatican. So let's break down this scripture. It says, "And the servant of the Lord must not strive." Strive means to quarrel, dispute, or to fight. "But be gentle unto all men, to teach patiently in meekness, instructing those who oppose themselves." The word "oppose themselves" is G475, which means to set oneself in opposition, causing heated arguments within oneself. This is our duality, our opposing energies, the angel and the demon that is warring against each other inside of us. And so
teachers like myself are supposed to be patient while others come to the truth, and we are supposed to be humble and not get angry when people don't listen to us because they've been spiritually blind. And I'll be the first to admit that I have been guilty of losing my patience when people can't see what I'm trying to reveal to them because they are spiritually blind. And then it goes on to say, if God will give them repentance to acknowledging the truth, that means when you repent to the Lord God, He gives you the spiritual eyes to see the truth, and then you are able to be converted and flip that opposing energies in one direction towards Christ, the Lord God in heaven, so that you may recover yourself out of the trap, out of the snare of the devil, who can take anyone captive at will because they are connected to the prince of the power of the air. And the word snare is a trap. Figuratively, a trick or temptation, a snare. Does this all make sense? And now when we look back to the double-headed phoenix statue or sculpture in the Vatican, you have those two opposing energies, which is represented by the double-headed phoenix, male and female, and then you have an image of a serpent ruling over each of those opposing energies. This is perfect. And now when we apply Isaiah 29:15, those who try to hide their plans from the Lord, they turn everything upside down and think, who will see us? You get an image of Abaddon, who is Apollyon, Satan, the prince of the power of the air, ruling over the dualistic system that each and every human being has inside of them. And if your spirit doesn't get converted before you die, you become fuel for that scorpion race in the pit. And here's another image: when you flip Abaddon upside down, it becomes a scorpion type of race with hair like women and tails like scorpion, very similar to what was described in the other images. And now you know why the Bible says that we are counted like sheep being led to the slaughter all day long, because our souls are being hunted to fuel this race that's going to be birthed out of the bottomless pit. If you guys are not blown away by the revelations that the Lord is revealing to us, I don't know what will. So enough talking about Elohim, the angels of the Supreme God that was mentioned in Genesis 1, and let's fast forward to Genesis 2 verse 4, where the Lord God created man and woman. Genesis 2 verse 4 states, "These are the generations of the heavens and the earth when they were created in the day that the Lord God made the earth and the heavens and every plant of the field before it was in the earth and every herb of the field before it grew." Most people have been taught through a religious institution that the Lord God mentioned in the scripture is the same as the God Elohim that's translated into gods or angels of the Supreme God that we just spent the last 48 minutes discussing in Genesis 1 is the same God, which is untrue. This has prevented everybody who ever read the Bible from understanding and being able to decipher the truth about the Word of God. When we trace these words back to the original Hebrew text in the Strong's Concordance, you get H3068, which translates to Jehovah, the self-existent or eternal Jehovah, the God of all gods. This is not Elohim described in Genesis 1. And so while he used Elohim to build the earth and create the earth, and Lucifer and his angels think that they are the gods of this earth, this is all part of the Lord God's master plan to supplant the earth, just like Jacob did Esau for his birthright. And this is where the story really gets interesting. And in Genesis 2 verse 7, we see where the Lord God formed man from the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and a man became a living soul. Let's listen to Jonathan Kleck describe the difference between Genesis 2 and Genesis 1.
Okay, I'm going to show you guys a couple scriptures real quick. We're in Genesis, look. I'm in Genesis 2 right here. I want to show you something. You see the word Adam right here? That's Hebrew word 121. That's when the Lord God, look, see, and out of the ground, the Lord God, watch this, the Lord, self-existent, eternal Jehovah, God, Elohim. Okay, now let me help you out with a conceptual thing. There's Elohim, which are gods, many gods, Elohim of the Supreme God. But then there's the Lord God, the self-existent eternal Elohim that never ends up producing, always. And you remember in heaven, there's what's called the Garden of God in Ezekiel 28. Thou wast in Eden, the Garden of God. What happens in the garden? There's spontaneous production of you know, whatever grows in the garden. And in this case, it's God's children, spontaneous growth in heaven. It's energy. It's God's energy, spontaneous. It's never ending. It's eternal. Now watch. Watch this. So, and out of the ground, the Lord God, look, the self-existent, eternal Jehovah Elohim formed every beast of the field and every fowl of the air and brought them unto, look, Adam. Hebrew word 121. Okay, now, let me just clear this up for everybody. Genesis 1 is not the Lord God. It is Elohim. It's the part that broke off and went and started the system. And that part gets cast down. That's what the earth is. It gets cast down to a system that's quarantined, which is the earth. And it begins dividing. Just think of cellular division now. So then they said, let us create man in our vain show, representative figure, especially an idol. That's what Elohim said. Watch. So remember, the first time we see the word Adam with a Kalik, capital A, like a proper name. See, capital A, D-A-M, Hebrew word 121. Watch this. Now let's go to Genesis 1. In the beginning, God, Elohim. Now don't forget, those are gods, but they're of the supreme God, right? Now, you might be going, well, wait a minute. What about the Lord, Elohim? That's also of the supreme God, because he is the Lord that was taken from the singularity and put into the system as the Lord Elohim, the one that's running everything. Now watch. So here we go. So right here, the spirit of Elohim, gods of the supreme God, angels, moved over the face as the part that turns of the waters and semen. Okay, so now go to 126, and it says, and Elohim said, let us make, and just use the word Elohim, and Elohim said, let us make man. Look at the word right here. You see the word 120? It's man. Let's click on that. Watch. That is Hebrew word 120. It means ruddy, that is a human being, individual of the species, hypocrite. And what's it say? Adam, Adam. I like saying this one as Adam, because it helps you delineate. So let us create Adam in our resemblance, hence a representative figure, especially an idol. So you know, now ready, the part that broke off, it cannot be purer. So that's what's forming the system, male and female. And so it forms a male and female system. Look, so Elohim created man. Look, Hebrew word 120, Adam, a hypocrite, human being, in his own image, resemblance, representative figure, especially an idol, vain show. So that's Lucifer and all the ones that came with him as a singularity. So many in one. Look at the back of your dollar bill. You ever wonder why it says e pluribus unum, many out of one, right? Welcome to the earth. So Elohim created man in his own image, in the image. So it repeats it, in the image of Elohim, gods of the supreme God, magistrates, created he him. Oh, wait, created he him? Well, yeah, because if it's Lucifer and all the angels that went with him, created he himself into male and female. He split and made male. Hey, y'all can have sex. You can inhabit host bodies. You're not going to die. It's all going to be a good, aka the Statue of Liberty. Why do you think the Statue of Liberty is the Queen of Heaven holding on to a penis with a scorpion stinger as a flame, with the DNA spiral staircase all the way to the ground, standing on top of an 11-pointed star, which represents a host body, shell, peel, or husk? Kalpa, I've shown it to you so many times. I'm going to go over this with all the imagery in the next video, but right now I'm just going to explain it. Watch this. Okay, so Elohim, angels, gods, angels of the supreme God, created man in his own image. Where did they come from? Where did all that come from? Well, it came from the singularity that's El, the Most High Supreme God, El. Well, it broke off and it was cast down to the earth, and now you got a quarantine system called the earth, and then it turns into male and female. Was that, what was that original energy? What was it? Male. Our Father who art in heaven. So then they come down and they create a system that's dual, male and female, to occupy as host bodies. So in the image of God created he him, male and female, and Elohim bless him. Isn't it perfect? Barak. Who do you think the Antichrist is? And he said, be fruitful and multiply. So they're going to go out and they're going to multiply and replenish the earth and have sex and make babies and all that good stuff. Now watch. So then here in Genesis 2, it says, it doesn't say the Lord God until Genesis 2:4. These are the generations of the heavens and the earth when they were created in the day that the Lord God made the earth and the heavens. Because, again, ready? If you have a singularity that's in like the vast expanse of space, and that whole thing is El, that's the Almighty God, and part breaks off, and that's Elohim, and it comes and it starts a system. And then the Lord God, the self-existent eternal Jehovah God, he's like the general contractor. He owns it all, even in the new system. Do you understand? El, Jesus said, my kingdom is not of this world. Jesus's kingdom isn't of this world. It's not here. He told Pilate, my kingdom, are you? Pilate said, are you a king? Basilius tus? Rexis tus? He's like, yes, but my kingdom's not of this world. So El comes into the system as Emmanuel, and the word Emmanuel means with us is El, the Almighty God. So Jesus said, I and my Father are one. So Emmanuel, Emmanuel means with us is, and the word El is the Almighty God. And El is the Almighty God that's abode is heaven. But he's also here in the earth as well. And let me show you his representative. Watch this. This is amazing. So the Lord God made the earth and the heavens. So who really made them? Well, the Lord God did, because he's in control of everything. But still, Elohim did it as a separate act. And now watch. And every planet, here we go. I want to get down to here. And look, and the Lord God formed man. This is a potter. As a potter from the dust, which is clay. So in Genesis 2:7, you have to understand this. The Lord God, the self-existent, eternal Jehovah God, formed Adam, man. Look, look at the word man. It's Hebrew word 120. I'm going to make it an unusual color. It's Hebrew word 120. You see that? It's the same word as Genesis 1. It says, ruddy, a human being, an individual of mankind, a hypocrite. He formed man of the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils. Here you go. Ready? The breath of life. Now, let me ask you this. Is the Lord God, the self-existent eternal Elohim, separated now from the system that was El, the Almighty God? Yes, because it's in the system now. It's part of this system. Now watch what he does. Now, and this proves it all out. Watch what he does. Okay, so, and the Lord planted a garden. It says, see it, it says, as fenced. Okay, do y'all remember the progressive commercial where Jamie is a white dude inside the white fence and he's in there, and then the black guy and Flo show up and Jamie goes and runs and jumps out of the fence? Yeah, stop and think about it for a sec. That's a representation of the devil and the concubine. Now watch, here we go. So he planted a garden. Remember the progressive commercial? It was a fenced area that Jamie jumped out of. Look up the meaning of Jamie. Here we go. Now watch this. Here we find out that here, and the Lord God said, it is not good for the man should be alone. I will make for him a help to meet for help meet for him. Okay, there you go. A counterpart, a front, that is a part opposite. Look, part opposite, a counterpart. So he puts him to sleep, and then look at his name now. His name is Adam. His name is Adam now. Out of all of a sudden, it's no longer man. It's a capital A, and it's a Hebrew word, 121. Watch. See? All of a sudden, the Lord God right here has breathed into him, look, and the Lord God formed man out of the dust as a potter from clay, and he breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, ready to make alive, and man became a living soul right there. Okay, so in this instance, in Genesis 2:7, the total difference is that eternal energy that's part of El enters into Adam as a living soul. Watch this. Now I'm going to show you exactly who that guy is right there, Adam. Now don't forget, the word for man in Genesis 1 is Adam, like Adam. Let's call it Adam, Hebrew word 120, Adam. And right here, what the Lord God breathed the breath of life and man became a living soul, an eternal living soul, that's Adam with a capital A, and it's Hebrew word 121. I just showed it to you. It's the first time the name is used properly as, there it is. See, look, Hebrew word 121, ready? Adam, the name of the first man, right there. Okay, I'm going to change that color right there. So, but it's different, but look, it's associated to one as 120. It's associated, but it's also separate. You understand? So now it's capital A-D-A-M, and it's Hebrew word 120. Because what nobody has really ever understood about the Bible, and this was my birthday present on John 3:16. My name's John, and on my birthday is 3:16. And the night before my birthday, I prayed and I said, Lord, please help me show people and let them understand the simplicity. So you already have a male-female system on the earth that has multiplied and populated. And then the Lord God puts a fenced area in called Eden on the earth. And then he puts Adam in there. He forms man. He forms man out of the dust. And then he breathes into his nostrils a living soul. He gives him that soul, that energy. And then from his side, he takes Eve. Did you ever wonder why Jesus was pierced in the side? Because the Lord's God's willing to give himself as a sacrifice that everything can exist. That's why. So then you have male and female created by Elohim all over the planet. You have Adam and Eve that's got God's spirit in them, and then they intermix, and then welcome to the world of good and evil. Okay, now watch this. Let me prove that out now. Ready? Ready? Let's go to 1 Corinthians 15, verse 45. Okay, here we go. This proves it out. Okay. So it is written, the first man, Adam, look, capital A-D-A-M. But here it's Greek word 76. See, G-76. But it tells you this is Hebrew origin right there. It's from H-121. Adam, the first man, pay very close attention, of Jesus, oh my gosh, as his representative, oh my gosh. So who was Adam in the Garden of Eden? The one that the Lord, that was the Lord God putting his spirit into the system. And so he controls everyone that comes back, and he runs the entire system. Even though Elohim, that's corrupted and left, thinks it's their deal. See, Elohim still believes they own this place. They run it. They think it's theirs. This is our escape route. We're going to build the Statue of Liberty to show it's ours. Wrong. That's where this ministry came in as well. Emmanuel is with us is El, the Almighty God. So Emmanuel comes into the system when, you know, when Jesus arrives. Well, don't forget this. The Lord God's still in the system because everything's bread. So he's in control of everything everywhere. And so he can catch any soul he wants. Every soul that's put into the system, every soul, he's in charge of who you are, what body you're in, who your parents are, where you were born. He's in charge of every single thing about your life. That's why he said, I knew you before the foundations of the world. And he appointed you to go forth and bear fruit. It says, I believe it's Romans 8, for those whom he did foreknow, those he justified, he sanctified, he glorified. That's us. So now we know, who is Adam? Watch this. Who is Adam? And so it is written, the first man, Adam, that's capital A-D-A-M, that is not from Genesis 1, that's from Genesis 2. The first man, Adam, I'll click on it, I'll prove it. Hebrew word 121, Adam, the first man of Jesus, as his representative, Adam. See, that's Genesis 2. That's one that the Lord God formed from the dust. And it says, was made a living soul. Now we know it's exactly right. Because when you click on it, it says immortal soul. So that's when man became a living soul. And then it says, and the last Adam, which is Christ, Adam as of Jesus, as his representative, which was Jesus, was made a quickening spirit. Divine God, Christ, Holy Spirit. So see, he's been running the system since the beginning. And the apostasy that occurred was Elohim. And so then the Lord God Elohim, the self-existing eternal Elohim, is in the system. And the Lord God's going to get back whoever he wants to go back, because he's in control. Now, you ready? Did you ever wonder? I mean, think about this. This used to blow my mind. I'm like, what? When I watched that video on YouTube of the guy singing in front of a big dead sheep that's a penis and a vagina, it's a dead sheep and it's got semen rolling down the side of a penis, I'm like, they're singing to Lucifer donning his own creation? You know what Lucifer means, don't you? The light bringer. Who do you think the light was that he brought away as merchandise? Us. Yeah, the light bringer. What are Elohim? The shining ones. We're from that original, let's call it ball of energy. We're from that original energy that's light. In him there is no darkness. So part of that light gets taken away, starts a system called the earth. And who's the one that brought it? The light bringer, because he brought the light from heaven, started a planet, started an earth, and I don't want to hear all about, oh, you know, this planet's not a planet, like, whatever. Started a system called the earth, started it, and then the Lord God is still in charge of it. It's perfection. And it's right here in the Bible. Can't argue with this. I mean, this is just not arguable. There it is. The first man, Adam, right there. Adam, the first man of Jesus. Man as his representative, Adam. See it right there? So now let me prove to you that who I am in Christ. When the Lord showed me all this stuff, like, to see the truth, you got to turn everything upside down. I was like, oh my God, why is the virgin a dead sheep? Well, now it all makes sense. You want to die? Go for the virgin. That's how you kill God's angels. Watch. So let's go to Isaiah. Before I go to Isaiah 29, I'm going to take you to Genesis 2 again. I want you to read the words yourself. and the Lord God, the self-existent eternal Jehovah Elohim formed. Read this word right here. It's Yatzar. See it? 3335 Yatzar. As a potter, he formed man from the dust, clay. See, it says clay. So the Lord God formed as a potter man from the clay. And then he breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and man became a living soul. Okay, remember those words. Formed as a potter, dust means clay. Now let's go to the scripture that the Lord used in the very beginning to resolve this for me, so I didn't jump off a bridge. I was like, God, freaking out. Okay, so here we go. So this is the Jonathan Kleck scripture that the Lord used to okay, ready? Surely your turning of things upside down. So, ready? Surely your turning of things upside down shall be esteemed as, surely your turning of things upside down shall be esteemed as the potter's clay. Look, es yatsar, there it is, especially as a potter and clay. For shall the work say of him that made it, he made me not? Or shall the thing that is framed say of him that framed it, he had no understanding? And then it says down here, and in that day the deaf shall hear the words of the scroll Biblia. Let's see, hear the words of the, where'd it go? Of the scroll, the book, look, scroll, bill, book, evidence, scroll, shall hear the words of the scroll, and the eyes of the blind, literally or figuratively, like film over the eyes, like you can't see, look, as skin, as naked, by implication, leather, hide. That's from the Garden of Eden, guys. Skin as naked. That's the exact same word when the Lord God made coats of skin for Adam and Eve, because the spiritual beings got caught in the fleshly system as his representative so he could redeem the whole earth back to himself. It's mind-boggling. So there it is. Look. Surely your turning of things upside down shall be esteemed as the potter's clay. That's what we saw in Genesis 2. When the Lord God formed Adam, formed, look, especially as a potter, same as Genesis 1, the Lord God formed Adam, Yatzar, formed man, Yatzar, from the clay. There it is, potter's clay. So how are you esteemed as a potter's clay? Surely your turning of things upside down shall be esteemed as the potter's clay, the original, the real deal. Not the Elohim thing in Genesis 1, which is the carnal thing. Now we're back to the king. Now watch this. In that day, the deaf, whether it's literal or spiritual deaf, shall hear the words of the scroll. I'm going to write there a scroll. And the eyes of the blind, literally or figuratively, watch this. I'm going to walk it back. Blind, film over the eyes. Okay, what snakes happen to their eyes? They have film over them when they shed. Watch this. As skin as naked, by implication, hide or leather, look, to be made bare, to be made naked. That is Genesis 3. Watch. Genesis 3. When the Lord God makes for them coats of skin. And unto Adam and also his wife did the Lord God make coats, ready, to cover with a garment of skins, ready, skin as naked, by implication, hide, leather, skin, to be bare, to be made naked. So see, spiritual beings that were made naked means you got a suit of nakedness, which is your host body. I was like, yes! perfection in understanding of the word now.
Guys, I don't know if you grasp what you just listened to, but the scroll is unrolled. The mystery of the world has just been solved. Jonathan just proved that we are all angels trapped in host bodies, and we were once light beings in heaven that were cast down, brought to this world by Lucifer, clothed with nakedness, which is the flesh, and we are trapped in human host bodies. And if our spirit does not get converted with the spirit of Christ before we die, our spirit becomes food for that locust, scorpion, serpent race that is being birthed in the bottomless pit. And now you know why we're told not to love the world or anything in it, because anyone who loves this world is not of the Father. Okay, let's do a recap. So far, I provided visual and scriptural evidence to prove that Lucifer led God's angels astray from a relationship with the Lord God in heaven to the earth, where he created himself both male and female, and then he created a pre-Adamic man, both male and female as well. After the Lord God created Adam and Eve from the dust of the earth, which was the real man as Christ's representative in the system, so that he could come back and redeem everybody, Satan then birthed his spirit into every human being through the intermingling of his seed with Adam and Eve, producing our dualistic nature, represented by this double-headed phoenix who Satan rules over the entire system until the Lord God supplants it. This dualistic system is the tree of knowledge and good and evil described in Genesis 2:17, which we'll talk about later in the video. I also proved using images that the Lord led me to within the altar of St. Peter, along with scriptural proof in Ezekiel 13:20, that the human host body is being used as a transmutation device to destroy God's angels by converting our angelic energy, which is our soul, to birth this below ground scorpion serpent race that's going to be birthed out of the bottomless pit in the end time, which will be Abaddon or Apollyon or Satan's army. So if Satan is known as the prince of the power of the air, and he is able to broadcast thoughts and attitudes and to see into every human host body represented by the all-seeing eye of Lucifer, and is able to take captive at his will those who have not been converted with the spirit of Christ, described in 2 Timothy verse 2, then there must be some type of frequency that connects the entire human host body as one hive mind that connects each of our evil doppelgangers, referred to as the worm that never dies, described in Mark 9:48 in the pit, then we should be able to see this frequency or this spirit manifesting itself in the physical world. But before we move forward, let me share my personal testimony to share with you how I came to this understanding. When I was first saved and the Holy Spirit descended down upon me, it changed my physical energy. I felt within my spirit, even before I watched any videos on YouTube or read one page in the Bible, I felt that my spiritual energy had been converted and I was no longer part of this world. I was separated and I was connected to a new source. So frequencies have always captivated my attention ever since I was saved. And it just so happened that the Lord gave me an energy company that provided systems integration for synchrophasor technology, which basically measured oscillations on the electric power grid. So I understood a little bit about frequencies. And I think that's why I was so drawn to try to figure out the big picture of how the prince of the power of the air is using these frequencies. And what I found out was much greater than I ever imagined, because the Lord led me to so much more, which I'll explain in this video. So eventually I was led to this video clip where this gentleman was explaining to his audience how certain vibrational frequencies held these sacred geometrical patterns in shape when tuned to the right frequencies. And I truly didn't grasp the concept of that until I started making this video. One of the images in this video that was revealed to me was Metatron's cube, which I later learned was a very occultic symbol that is found in Jewish mysticism or the Kabbalah. And this led me down another whole path of research. The Kabbalah has been defined as the mystical expression of the Torah, which are the Hebrew scriptures. The Kabbalah views this secret mystical knowledge as a path towards immortality, which involves intensive and non-traditional religious mystical activities such as chanting and meditation to synchronize one's own vibrational frequencies in order to achieve that higher level of consciousness to commune with God. Merkaba mysticism is the foundation of Jewish mysticism, or the Kabbalah, that dates back to the ancient mystery religions of ancient Egypt. This is the metaphysical relationship between mind and matter, the spirit and the flesh. Mer means light, Ka means spirit, Ba means body, light, spirit, body.
So when specific vibrational frequencies are achieved, this produces sacred geometric shapes such as Metatron's cube and the Platonic solids that can be observed, which explains the metaphysical relationship between mind and matter, the spirit and the flesh, because the human body is made up of atoms and 60% water and our spiritual energy that is trapped inside. And all things are held together with vibrational frequencies. That is the mystery. The Kabbalah and other mysticism like it, like the New Age movement, is just man's vain attempt to escape from the tree of knowledge of good and evil that Adam and Eve were told by God, you shall not eat, neither shall you touch it, lest you die. We are the tree of knowledge of good and evil. When we were led astray to the earth and took on host bodies, and Eve fornicated with the serpent, we all became yoked to a demon, producing our dualistic nature. Our flesh bodies became our death sentence, and unless we take from the tree of life, who is Jesus, we will die. Jesus says in John 10:9-10, I am the door. By me, if any man enters, he will be saved and shall go in and out and find pastures. The thief cometh not but to steal and kill and destroy. So anybody who's pursuing a path to immortality without through Jesus is a robber and a thief, and it's not going to bode well for them. You have to understand that this is real. This is not something made up or some Hollywood script. This is truly a form of ancient witchcraft and what the Kundalini spirit in yoga and the New Age movement is all about. It's opening the third eye, the pineal gland, and synchronizing one's own vibrational energy or frequency to the divine source to achieve that higher level state of consciousness beyond duality. And this allows them to gain access to the spirit realm, to the divine source, which is Lucifer, because anyone who goes through the gate without Jesus is a robber and a thief. Throughout the centuries, rabbinic sages have sought to duplicate the experience of Ezekiel's vision of God's throne, described as the wheels within the wheels carried by four living creatures in Ezekiel 1. But unlike Ezekiel's experience, which was initiated by God, the mystics of the Kabbalists use occult methods to achieve union with the divine source, apart from having Jesus Christ. And this is known as Merkaba mysticism, symbolized by the Sephiroth tree and the six-pointed star, also known as Metatron's cube. Merkaba's mysticism believes that they can recreate Ezekiel's wheels. Ezekiel's wheels are the counter-rotating fields of light between the spirit and the body. It's spirals of energy, as in DNA, which transports the spirit and the body from one dimension to another. It's actually the interdimensional vehicle consisting of two equal sides, interlocked tetrahedrons of light with a common center, and it can be viewed as a three-dimensional Star of David. Now you know what all this mysticism and all this symbology is all about that we find littered throughout the world. And so life as we know it is held together by these frequencies, from the creation of two cells which forms the vesica Pisces, represented by the Kabbalistic seed of life, the flower of life, the tree of life, and Metatron's cube that produces the sacred geometric Platonic solids which forms and holds in place the structure of atoms at the molecular level to form our DNA and to bind together all matter and spirit, which creates the human host body, which in Jewish mysticism in the Kabbalah is known as the Sephiroth and the Kelopoth. The Sephiroth is the good spark from God, and the Kelopoth, which translates into a peel, shell, or husk, is the human host body, which houses the essence of evil or impure spiritual forces in Jewish mysticism. It's the polar opposite of the holy Seraphoth. It's the realm of evil, also termed as the Sitra Achra. This is literally the tree of knowledge of good and evil. This is the twin system inside of us, the good and the evil, the yang and the yang, the two opposing male and female energy that the Lord God is going to take vengeance on and burn it all, because we were never meant to take on flesh bodies. This is why Jesus says in Galatians 5:17 that the flesh is in opposition to the spirit. And because we all have DNA from the serpent, who is the prince of the power of the air, he is able to see into every human host body, and it's through his frequency that our spiritual energy is slowly being transmuted from an angel to a demon, from male energy to female energy, represented by this metaphysical transmutation circle, which is our flesh, because God's energy is male. We pray to our Father. This is what is meant in Ephesians 6:12, where it says, we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against the principalities, against the powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against the spiritual wickedness in high places. Because this is a spiritual battle that's going on inside of us. It's the female energy warring against the male energy. Now you know why the world has a gender identity crisis, with men wanting to have sex change operations to become female, The female energy is consuming the male energy. It's taking over. The prophet Daniel prophesizes in Daniel 12:1, and it says, "And at the time Michael shall stand up, the great prince which stands before the children of thy people, and there shall be a time of trouble such as never was, since there was a nation even to that same time. And at that time thy people shall be delivered, every one that shall be found written in the book of life." When you look at the translation of the word trouble here, it translates to a female rival, an adversary, affliction, distress, tribulation. And then when you look at the word nation, it says a flight of locusts. Do you understand what this is saying? It's the female rival taking over, transmuting into a nation, which is the flight of locusts that are coming. Okay, let's bring this home. Let me show you what Metatron's cube is all about and how it has manifested in the world. Metatron's cube is the prince of the power of the air. It is what locks us into our duality within the human host body. And that's why Jesus came into this system, to reconcile the two opposing energies. The two became one. One thief mocked Jesus, the other thief repented. And when he repented, he got a new spirit and the two became one. And that's what Jesus does for us. He unlocks the cube. Similar to what we discussed earlier in the video, Kabbalists believe that there is a divine spark from God within every person of creation. The Kabbalist believes that the Messiah himself also fell into the abyss, and that he too is exiled and will be released from the pit when a critical mass or a spark will be a calling for him to come forth into the earth. Now you know what CERN is all about. They are trying to open up the pit. And now you know what that image of that Illuminati ceremonial mass that appeared in the image of CERN provided by CERN themselves was all about. It is them trying to open up this pit and bring forth the Messiah at the right time. And their Messiah is none other than the fallen angel Metatron, and through rabbinic writings is identified as Yeshua. Not our Yeshua, Jesus Christ, their false Yeshua, whose primary role is to act as the mediator and carry their prayers to Jehovah, which is the supreme God, El. But because they have not believed in Jesus Christ, their El, their Jehovah, is Lucifer. And that's why Lucifer, who is Satan, who is the deceiver of the whole world, masquerades like an angel of life. He has deceived the whole world, and these people are the most deceived. Isn't it interesting how they have Shiva outside the building of CERN, and Shiva just happens to stand for the supreme God? You cannot make this stuff up. And now we know what visual evidence to look for. We see Metatron's cube symbology, otherwise known as Saturn's cube, manifesting in plain sight all around the world. You see Metatron's cube symbology in Amazon, Gateway Computers, Nintendo Cube Game. It's in movies like Hellraiser, the Rubik's Cube, Boston Logan National Airport, Australia, Denmark, Manhattan, Santa Ana. It's the symbology for the religion of Islam. It's in D-Wave Computer, which is another whole video in itself. But let's just listen to the founder of D-Wave Computer talk about it for a little bit.
But science has reached the point now where we can build machines that exploit those other worlds. And quantum computers are perhaps the most exciting of all of these that we have within, or almost within, our grasp right now. So if you have the opportunity to stand next to one of these machines, it is an awe-inspiring thing, at least for me. It feels like an altar to an alien god. They really are impressive machines.
An altar to an alien god. There it is, guys. The founder of D-Wave Computing telling you where he got this technology. They're accessing another dimension, other spiritual or fallen angels from a different dimension. That reminds me of Revelation 13:15. And the second beast was able to give breath to the image of the first beast so that the image could speak and cause all who refuse to worship it be killed. This is artificial intelligence, guys. This is D-Wave Computing.
And here's an image of a fake Jew wearing a black cube that's described in Revelation 2:9, where it says, "I know your affliction and your poverty. Though you are rich, I am aware of the slander of those who falsely claim to be Jews, but are in fact of the synagogue of Satan."
And probably the most in-your-face type of mockery is the Satan's cube at the 9/11 memorial at Ground Zero in New York City. There's a light cube on the surface and a dark inverted cube going into the ground, representing the angel of the bottomless pit. As above, so below. The light and the dark. And in case you haven't made the connection to 9/11 yet, let me spell it out for you. Revelation 9/11 is the angel of the bottomless pit. That's why the Twin Towers were destroyed on 9/11. This is symbolic of Satan saying that he has taken over the host body twin system. The two energies have become one. This is represented by the One World Freedom Tower. The two DNA, the two twin towers were destroyed and the two have become one. And if you don't believe me, let's just look at this clip from Back to the Future, because it clearly spells it out that they were intentionally destroyed. And it even shows on a sign the frequency that makes Metatron's cube, 116 hertz. And when you turn and flip the sign upside down, it's 9/11, the angel from the bottomless pit.
You're Dr. Brown. The night that I go back in time, you will be shot by terrorists. Please take whatever precautions are necessary to prevent this terrible disaster.
In the 1985 classic, Back to the Future, at a scene called the Twin Pines Mall, we will bear witness to a sudden surprise terrorist attack, perpetrated by a group of Muslim terrorists. The attack is at the Twin, which is a reference to the Twin Towers. When we turn the sign upside down, the digits on the clock read 911 or 911. The Twin Pines are a symbolic representation of the Twin Towers. Before the terrorist attack, the Twins are present, but after the attack, the Twins are gone, replaced with a single pine. This takes place on 9/11, where the Twins are destroyed and replaced with a single tower, the One World Trade Building. Also at this scene, Doc shows us two stopwatches, both of which display encoded 9/11s. Is this only a coincidence? The pines are the towers, and this symbol system is confirmed in Back to the Future Part 2, where we see the Twin Pines appear again on a projection movie screen in Marty's future house. Marty's family gathers around the movie screen, and the Twin Pines actually morph into the Twin Towers. This is because the Twin Pines are the Twin Towers. The pines are the towers. Pines, towers. And the Twin Pines Mall is the Twin Towers Mall, which is why all the clocks here secretly say 9/11, and why there will be a Muslim terrorist attack resulting in the destruction of the Twin Pines, or the Twin Towers. But the appearance of the towers is not a random backdrop, as we can see the Statue of Liberty lurking just as secretly as the towers, making this scene a secret recreation of New York City, where Marty's family has gathered to stare at Ground Zero. Of these three characters staring at Ground Zero, one of them is completely upside down. But in the entire Back to the Future saga, this is the only time when an upside-down character will ever appear. The hint being given here is to observe the scene from his perspective by turning it upside down. But when doing so, the Twin Towers are clearly shown to be falling down. In the entire history of cinema, this scene of Back to the Future is the most literal depiction ever made showing the Twin Towers falling down. So how is it possible that this scene would occur in a story that already contains a terrorist attack by Muslims at the Twins on 9/11, where the Twins are the Twin Towers, which then execute Hollywood's best depiction of the Twin Towers collapse? Tower strike takes place, a giant flaming 9/11 is ignited in the street. Marty knows exactly when and where this tower strike will happen because it's all written on this flyer and placed in his hands, but something lurks in the background overseeing this transaction. But why does this symbol hover while Marty is forewarned about the tower strike?
And just in case you can't see the burning 9/11, I've highlighted here in yellow for you. So let's do a quick recap. We've seen visual evidence that matter is held in place through frequencies, and when these frequencies are tuned to 116 hertz, it forms Metatron's cube, which is found in Jewish mysticism, which produces these sacred geometric Platonic solids that holds everything in place and also explains the metaphysical relationship between mind and matter. We've seen evidence of how these frequencies have manifested in various forms and symbols throughout the world, such as Saturn's cube, and even in movies such as Back to the Future on the Twin Pine Mall sign band that read 116, which is the frequency that forms Metatron's cube. And when you turn it upside down, it reads 911, the angel from the bottomless pit described in Revelation 9:11. I hope you're not thinking that this is just all a coincidence, because there was numerous other commercials and movies that I could have used as an example to show you how this frequency is manifesting in movies and all forms of media, but I needed to keep this short. So the question is, what's the significance of the black cube of Saturn, and why throughout history and even today are people worshiping Saturn? To answer this question, we need to take a closer look at this heavenly host. And for those who have bought into the NASA lies about planets, nowhere in the Bible is there a mention of planets. There are only the sun, moon, and the stars, which are known as heavenly hosts or angels. So when we look at Saturn, we find a hexagon shape in the center, which we know makes up the geometric shape of Metatron's cube. And as I'm making this video and I'm speaking into this phone looking down at the clock is reading 9/11. I can't even count how many supernatural confirmations that the Lord has given me throughout making this video similar to this one. That would be a whole nother video within itself. So if in fact matter and energy are held together by sound and vibrational frequencies, could Saturn be the source of the Prince of the Power of the Air broadcasting frequencies to the Earth into every human host body? It certainly would explain the Saturn worship that we find throughout the world. Prior to becoming saved, I used to be a big fan of Dave Matthews, and one of my favorite songs was Satellite. So when we look at the lyrics to the song, it gives us a clue of what he's singing about. Funny, because prior to me being saved, I had no idea what he was talking about. Satellite in my eyes, like a diamond in the sky, how I wonder. So we know that diamonds in the sky is a reference to Lucifer, like Lucy in the Sky with Diamonds from the Beatles. Lucy, Lucifer, get it? So there's your reference to Lucifer. Then it goes on to say, satellite strung from the moon, in the world is your balloon, peeping Tom for the mother station. So satellite strung from the moon, in the world is your balloon, peeping Tom for the mother station. So the mother station sounds like Saturn, and the moon is a satellite broadcasting signals down to the balloon, which is the Earth. I mean, can you read this any other way? Winter's cold, spring erases, and the calm away from the storm is chasing. Everything good needs replacing. Look up, look down, all around, hey satellite. Everything good needs replacing. Who does that sound like? Satan. I'm going to show you one more example of how the Prince of the Power of the Air's spirit has manifested in this physical world in our state capital of Washington, D.C., where you'll see Metatron's cube intersect at all the major monuments and state houses and government institutions. By the end of this section, you should know who they're referring to, where it is written, "In God We Trust," on the United States currency.
Zooming into the area in front of the Capitol building, many researchers have identified Masonic compasses built into the street plan. The compasses that run along Pennsylvania and Maryland Avenues point to the White House and the Jefferson Memorial. The spread of the compasses is 1 royal mile. I might chalk this up to coincidence if it wasn't for the diagram Richard Heath has published in Sacred Number. Heath's diagram is drawn as a grid of equilateral triangles, so every edge measures 1 royal mile. The Jefferson Memorial, White House, and House of the Temple are centrally located on these nodes. The point of the pentagon facing the White House is at this node. This is simply too much coincidence to have not been the product of intentional design. I find the ancient Flower of Life diagram fits perfectly into this grid. The Flower of Life has been found all over the world. Wikipedia lists the Flower of Life in 15 countries so far. Here's the Flower of Life at the Osirion Temple in Abydos, Egypt. This is the second depiction of a cube we've seen in DC. Metrology, the science of measurement, is one of the keys to deciphering secret architecture. Each side of the larger cube spans 2 triangles, forming an edge length equal to 2 royal miles. Did you ever wonder why the US and Israel have such a strong bond? Many researchers have seen the Tree of Life from Jewish mysticism encoded in DC's traffic circles and monuments. However, DCSymbols.com is the only place that shows how the streets and traffic circles match this early depiction of the Porte Lucis Tree of Life from 1516. To understand why both the Flower of Life and Tree of Life are in DC, you need a 1-minute visual education in sacred geometry. The Flower of Life grows on the Tree of Life. Flower of Life geometry is based on the 2D reality that 6 circles fit perfectly around a central 7th, shown here with quarters. Flowers eventually bear fruit, and with a growth of circles, we have the traditional Fruit of Life diagram, containing 13 circles. Connecting the dots reveals Metatron's cube, an important diagram in the study of sacred geometry. Metatron's cube contains the five Platonic solids, both in smaller and larger scales, like a fractal. Platonic solids figure prominently in Plato's philosophy, after whom they were named. The dots and the interstices encode the pattern of two intersecting Pythagorean tetractyses. This is the pattern on the dollar bill, in what is called glory above the eagle's head. Pythagoreans swore an oath to the tetractys, which was the most important symbol in their secret worship of number. All of this symbolism is interconnected in a system. Masons studied for years to understand these things and advance through their degrees. Look at how many lucky 13s are on the obverse of the Great Seal. We've already seen the 13 stars of glory over the eagle's head. In the eagle's claws there are 13 arrows, 13 leaves on the branches hold 13 olives, and there are 13 stripes on the shield. Perhaps having 13 colonies was no accident. This center point of American democracy figured prominently in Dan Brown's The Lost Symbol. Investigative mythologist William Henry has interpreted the significance of the Capitol building as the solemn temple at the heart of America. Looking up through the oculus in the Capitol dome, we see Constantino Brumidi's huge fresco entitled Apotheosis of George Washington. The word apotheosis means elevation of a man into God. George Washington is sitting on a rainbow up in the clouds surrounded by 13 maidens and flanked by the goddesses Liberty and Victory. The fresco at the heart of America clearly elevates Washington into some kind of solar deity. Six allegorical groupings in a hexagonal arrangement tell stories centered on the ancient gods Mercury, Vulcan, Ceres, Minerva, Neptune, and Columbia. What does all this pagan symbolism have to do with the official history of the United States? Nothing. There are 72 stars surrounding the fresco, recalling the names of God in Jewish mystical tradition. An astronomical take on this number of stars is the fact that it takes 72 years for the Earth to precess 1 degree. Looking deeper, there are several crypto-references to the Egyptian goddess Isis, particularly in the allegory of agriculture. Flora with exposed breast and young America in liberty cap stand in front of Ceres, goddess of agriculture. A sheaf of wheat is often used to depict the goddess of nature, shown here as Virgo. An exposed breast and the liberty cap are well-known attributes of Isis, used extensively during the French Revolution. Here the symbols are shown together in Delacroix's Liberty Guiding the People. The goddesses personified on both sides of the Atlantic as Nature, Reason, Liberty, Freedom, and Columbia are all esoteric references to the Egyptian goddess Isis. To top it off, the goddess Freedom on the outside of the Capitol Dome and recently in the middle of the Capitol Visitor Center are yet more depictions of you-know-who. The architects of the Capitol are clearly obsessed with the secret worship of Isis.
So, the ancient religion of Babylon, they all have one thing in common, the sacred feminine. The sacred feminine. The sacred feminine. Ishtar the Babylonians, Tyre the Buddhism, Fatima of Muhammad, Sophia the Gnostics, Shekinah to the Kabbalist Jew, Mary to the Catholic, and Shakti to the Hindu. These all have one thing in common, the sacred feminine. And the sacred feminine is going to take you back to the source of light. Because the light that resides in that place that Plato talked about, you need a path to get back to that light. Listen, this is important. She is the one to take you to that light. Now, I'm gonna give you a guess. Tell me this morning, who do you think that light is? You remember what this subject's all about? Lucifer.
He's...
I hope you can truly comprehend what was just revealed. The Kabbalistic Flower of Life, the Kabbalistic Tree of Life, and Metatron's Cube, which we know from the Kabbalistic teaching, is the metaphysical path to the fallen angel Metatron, who is Lucifer, are all found in the architecture of the streets of Washington, D.C. Do you comprehend what it takes to architect and build a city based on these geometric patterns and shapes? In a moment, we're going to talk about the builders described in Matthew 21:42, where it says the stone that the builders rejected has now become the cornerstone, which we know is Jesus. But I want to ask this question. If the United States was built on Judeo-Christian values and ideals, then why can we not find one trace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, who is the Lord God in the flesh, while we can find other Egyptian gods such as Columbia, Liberty, and Isis for us to see in plain sight? And why is the city architecture built on the foundation of these ancient mystery religions of ancient Egypt, unless the God we trust on the dollar bill is another God? And this gives us a clue who the builders are in Matthew 21:42, where it says, the stone the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. It's well known that many of our founding fathers were Freemasons, and it's clear that the architects and the builders who built Washington, D.C. had knowledge and were clearly influenced by these ancient mystery religions of ancient Egypt, since the Flower of Life has been found as early as the first century in the Temple of Osiris in Egypt. In this next section, I'm going to share my testimony of how the Lord led me to the understanding that the original builder mentioned in the Bible is actually Lucifer, and it was actually his workmanship and what he was created for in heaven. Whenever I create a video like this, I constantly pray to the Lord to give me guidance and understanding to make sure that everything that I'm delivering to you folks is the truth, because the last thing I want to do is mislead anyone or go against the Word of God. So I was trying to connect the dots while I was making this video, and I was praying to the Lord to give me understanding on how Lucifer was able to convince a third of the angels to rebel against the Lord God and come into this system, start the earth, and how he has control over everyone through frequencies. And I was trying to put that all together, and through a series of supernatural dreams and circumstances, the Lord led me to that understanding, which I'm going to explain right now. It all started with a dream about a rat, and at the time I didn't realize what the dream meant. I thought that the Lord was trying to show me that there was going to be pestilences coming, because that's what's described as a birth pain in the end times. But I later learned that this was a little bit more significant, and he was leading me up to the understanding that he was about to reveal to me. So fast forward to a dream I had a couple of weeks ago. I was looking at an artwork or an image similar to the one in front of you, and Jonathan Kleck was there, but I couldn't see him. He was on the side, and he was saying, Rich, look within the image and look for the images within the image. And then all of a sudden, I heard the word angel flute, and I'm like, angel flute? And then all of a sudden, a flute started to emerge from the image within the image, and it looked exactly like this picture here. And this dream happened as I was just waking up, and I woke up, and I'm like, what the heck is an angel flute? I'm like, an angel flute? I mean, who even comes up with that concept? So I get out of bed, I Google the word angel flute, and the first thing that pops up is an identical image of what was in my dream. And eventually I was led to this image here, which is the Pied Piper. So I learned all about the story of the Pied Piper, about how he had a magical flute that he helped rid this town of all the rats, but the mayor of the town decided not to pay him, and in return he used his magic flute to lure all the children of the town away, and they were never seen again. So I'm trying to see the correlation correlation between the story of the Pied Piper and the story about Lucifer, about how he led a third of God's angels astray down to the earth. And I'm trying to get the correlation in my mind, and I just couldn't make it work. So I continued my research on angel flute, and I found a mystical meaning, and what it meant was to be used as a weapon, to use the frequency as a weapon. So I kept thinking to myself, this has got to be associated with the Pied Piper, and it's got to be associated with how God's angels were led astray by Lucifer. But I still couldn't make the connection in my mind, so I kind of just forgot about it for a little while. So about 2 to 3 days later, I'm watching television, and all of a sudden this Geico commercial comes on, and the band Rat is on the commercial, and I feel in my spirit the Lord is telling me it's about the rats. So once again, I get up and I do my research again, and I come back to this Pied Piper image again. But this image happened to have a title on it, and it said The Rise and Fall of Lucifer, the Musician. I was like, oh my Lord, now it started to make sense to me. So as I was scrolling down and looking for some scriptures that supported that Lucifer was a musician, I came across this image in front of you. You can't make this up. Super rat with a pyramid on it. Boy, does God have a sense of humor. So after I saw the image of the Super Rat motorcycle, I did what the Lord said, and I focused on the word rat, and I looked up the definition, and I couldn't believe what I found. The definition of the word rat is to betray, to desert one's party or cause. I mean, this is perfect, so now it all makes sense. So Lucifer and his legion of rats, his fallen angels, rebelled against the Lord God because Lucifer didn't get what he wants, so in return, he led God's angels astray to the earth with his angel flute, with his enchantment. I mean, this makes absolutely perfect sense. Now we know some people get redeemed and some people don't. It depends what your conviction was. And when we read Ezekiel 28, 13, and 14, we've learned more about Lucifer's identity and what his role was in heaven. This is an amazing revelation, and it explains everything. In Ezekiel 28, the Lord God says to Lucifer, "Thou hast been in Eden, the garden of God. Every precious stone was thy covering, the sardius, the topaz, the diamond, the beryl, the onyx, the jasper, the sapphire, the emerald, and the carbuncle, and the gold. The workmanship of thy tabrets and thy pipes was prepared in the day that you were created. Thou was the anointed cherub that covered that I had set on the top of the holy mountain of God. Thou hast walked up and down in the midst of the stones of the fire. Thou was perfect in thy ways from the day that thou was created till the iniquity was found in thee." When we unpack the scripture and we look at how the Lord God is describing Lucifer's appearance, we see that he is clothed, he is covered, he is entwined all together with all these precious stones in heaven. And all these stones are classified as crystals. A crystal is defined as a solid substance having naturally geometrically regular form with symmetrically arranged plane faces. And they are categorized into 7 groups which obey the physical laws of symmetry. And a crystalline state describes the strict arrangements of atoms or molecules within a structure. Crystals hold measurable electromagnetic power that can be used as a semiconductor in an oscillator or transducer to influence frequency or vibrational patterns. Are you getting this? They also enable the flow of electrons to resonate, amplify, and transmute energy. So by this description, Lucifer was made up of every precious and essential crystal that is required to symmetrically arrange atoms or molecules within a structure that also holds electromagnetic power to influence the frequency or vibrational patterns. Do you understand what we're reading here? And then the Lord goes on in the rest of the scripture to say, "The workmanship in thy tabrets and thy pipes were prepared in the day that you were created." When we look at the meaning of the word workmanship here, it translates to deputyship, general employment, work, occupation. And when we look at tabrets and pipes, we know that these are both musical instruments. So we have workmanship, employment, occupation, musical instruments that were prepared in the day that Lucifer was created and covered with all the precious stones or crystals that are required to symmetrically arrange atoms or molecules within a structure and also influence the vibrational frequency of these patterns and structures. So the Lord God created Lucifer as his deputy, as his musician, as his general contractor to build things. And this is what Jonathan Kleck has been saying from the beginning, but no one has believed him. And here are the scriptures to prove that he has been right. And now I'm going to bring things full circle. In the remaining of the scripture, it says how Lucifer was on the holy mountain of the Lord God, and he walked up and down the midst of the stones of the fire. When we look at the Strong's Concordance of the word stone, it means to build, a mason. And now you know who the builders are in Matthew 21:42. The stone that the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. It's the modern day Freemasons that can be traced all the way back to heaven, where Lucifer was the general contractor for the Lord God, and he was the original builder. That's why the Freemasons and secret societies worship Lucifer, because he was the builder of this world. And when we look up the element of fire, we find that it's the tetrahedron found in Metatron's cube. The tetrahedron is the platonic solid that represents the element of fire and perpetuates the balance and stability between the physical and spiritual, the mind and matter, the spirit and the flesh. This is how Lucifer is able to see into every human being and take captive at his will, described in 2 Timothy. This is the all-seeing eye. This is the prince of the power of the air, spirit working in the children of disobedience, described in Ephesians 2:2. And this is how he is using frequency to manipulate humanity. Now you know why he's in control of the music industry. He's the original Pied Piper, leading God's angels into destruction. And to wrap up Ezekiel 28, when the Lord God said, "Thou wast perfect in all your ways from the days that thou was created till iniquity was found in thee," because Lucifer was one of God's angels who could create things. He was a creator. That's where he got his arrogance from. He thought he could be like God because he was creating things, and that's where God saw into his heart and saw the pride and saw the pomp where he wanted to be like God, because he thought he could do God's job. And that's where he fell, and that's why he was cast out and convinced a third of the angels to follow him. And now you know where the term King of the Mountain comes from, because Lucifer wanted to topple the King of all kings, the Lord God El in heaven. And so now when we read John 1, it brings on a whole new meaning. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The same was in the beginning with God. All things were made by him, and without him was not anything made that was made. In him was life, and the life was the light of men, and the light shineth in the darkness, and the darkness could not comprehend it. Because not only is the Word of God so perfect, but the Word of God spoke everything into existence through sound, through vibrational frequency that created everything. It's mind-blowing. And the darkness, Lucifer could not comprehend it, because he couldn't even understand, even though he was a creator, the depth and complexity of the Lord God. I don't know about you guys, but I'm blown away. Now I know why the Bible says, "And you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free," because Jesus is the truth, and all things were created through him. It's mind-blowing. In this next section, Jonathan Kleck is going to explain to you how the dualistic nature that governs the human host body, which is the flesh, the male and female energy warring inside every human host body that started in the Garden of Eden, has come to an end, and the cycle has come full circle to what we see transpiring in the world today to bring about Satan's one world government and the rule of the Antichrist. When you have finished watching this next section and combine it with all the information that has been revealed in this video, you will know that it's the end of the world and Jesus is returning to take vengeance on the flesh, this dualistic system, and to bring judgment to those who have rejected him and to those who have not believed.
Pray that God took them quick. And then we saw the people jumping. We saw what we thought was debris, and we realized it was people jumping.
People are falling to their deaths, jumping from the flames in the buildings. I just want to mention, if people do anything, say prayers for the people.
Exitus acta probat. The outcome justifies the deed. The origin of the phrase itself traces back to Niccolo Machiavelli. In the book The Prince, written by Niccolo Machiavelli, he asserts that in politics, the killing of innocence and deceit is necessary in maintaining power, as well as controlling the population of a state through deceitful politics. The phrase, "the ends justifies the means," or the outcome justifies the deed, would come to identify Machiavelli as a teacher of evil and treachery. Subsequently, the term Machiavellian would be coined to represent evil and deceit, especially in politics and in government. Is it possible that the destruction of the Twin Towers was actually a public proclamation of triumph of a government that was established as far back as the account of Adam and Eve in the book of Genesis in the Bible? What if the bombing of the Twin Towers was actually just a message stating that an evolution of a government that started in the Garden of Eden had finally come to fruition? Okay, folks, in this section, we're just going to do a straight up talk to each other. I'm going to talk to you and I'm going to present evidence so you understand that the bombing of the Twin Towers is literally a manifestation that goes all the way back to the Garden of Eden. And once you understand this, and once you've taken hold of this, nothing that's happening in the world today will surprise you or scare you, because you'll understand it. The Bible says you'll know the truth and the truth will set you free. By the way, Jesus is the truth. Okay, so let's talk about Genesis for a second. Let's go all the way back to the beginning of the Bible. And God created Adam and Eve. They were created beings. And they were given certain orders by God that they should not partake, or neither should they touch the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. And I want to read something to you. I know most of y'all have probably never heard. I'm going to read to you an account from Genesis 4. It says, "And Adam knew Hava, his wife, who had desired the angel. And she conceived and bare Cain. And she said, I have acquired a man, the angel of the Lord. And she added to bear from her husband Adam his twin, even Habel." Okay, now let me tell you where that came from. That came from what's called the Targum. Now, the Targum predates the King James Bible. The King James Bible was written after the Targum. So, if you're looking for the exact wordage or verbiage or translation of what happened in the garden, you're doing better to go look at the Targum, because the Targum is what the rabbinical teachers used to teach everybody as they sat down. They read from the Targum in Aramaic. Now, the King James Bible has evolved from that. It's not the other way around. So I want to read to you now the same thing from Genesis 4 in this King James Bible. It says, "And Adam knew Eve, his wife, and she conceived and bare Cain and said, I have gotten a man from the Lord, and again bare his brother Abel." Okay, so in these very few sentences, it says, once again, "And Adam knew Eve, his wife, and she conceived and bare Cain and said, I have gotten a man from the Lord, and she again bare his brother Abel." It doesn't say she conceived again. They were twins. Now, when you go to the Targum and you just go do a little homework, "And Adam knew Hava, his wife, who had desired the angel." Now, this is the serpent we're talking about. "And she conceived and bare Cain, and she said, I have acquired a man, the angel of the Lord, and she added to bear from her husband Adam his twin, even Habel," H-A-B-E-L. Okay, from the very beginning in the garden, there was this twin paradigm, Cain and Abel. Well, Cain killed his brother Abel. It's kind of interesting, because the whole system that we're in is cannibalistic. It's the serpent eating its own tail right there. That's called the Ouroboros. And the serpent eating its own tail represents the system that we live in. It literally is vampiric. And when Cain killed Abel, it was a manifestation of the government that was established in the very beginning. One kills the other. And now, let me explain to you. That same government exists in every human being. There's a good Jonathan, and there's a bad Jonathan. There's a good you and a bad you.
You are your own twin. You have this dichotomy that's going on. There's a good you and a bad you. And that's why Christ came, was to rectify the situation. Now, I want everybody to go back to Genesis. It said, now the serpent was more subtle than any beast of the field which the Lord God had made. And he said unto the woman. So the serpent, which is called the Nakash, and it's called a Nakash because of the hissing sound it makes when it speaks. It's not a snake. It is it's an upright humanoid fallen angel, or I shouldn't say humanoid. It's an upright fallen angel serpent being that's talking to Eve. And it makes a hissing sound when it speaks. And when it says that he said to the woman, the word for woman is adulteress. Now, we're talking in Genesis 3. So Eve hadn't even been with Adam yet. So by definition, the word adulteress is someone that's had sex outside the covenant of marriage from the partner she has. Well, her partner was Adam. God created them. They were created beings. So she conceived with the serpent, and it says in Genesis, once again, she said, the Lord said, we shall not eat from the tree, neither shall we touch it, lest we die. So a lot of people may have been taught something different, but you haven't been taught the truth. So Eve conceived with the serpent. She also conceived with Adam. There's a type of twin that's called heteropaternal superfecundation. And it's where a woman conceives twins from different fathers.
And one of nature's rarest events confirmed in New Jersey. A woman gave birth to twins, but each child has a different biological father. Before you say, what? Listen up. The evidence was discovered this week in a paternity case. The woman's from Paterson, New Jersey, and is suing one of the men for child support. DNA tests show that he was the father to one baby, but not the other, except a woman conceiving simultaneously from two different men.
So at the very beginning of humanity, Satan's government was established by the intersection of the very first two cells, which was the seed of the serpent and the seed of the woman. And that began this whole government where everybody on planet Earth would be their own worst enemy. They would have a duality of mind. They would do good, they would do bad, they would do right and wrong, light and dark, right side up and upside down. I'm wearing this shirt on purpose. When two cells intersect, they come towards each other and then they intersect. And the intersection of those two cells makes that thing that looks like a football or an all-seeing eye. It's called a Venn diagram. It's also called the all-seeing eye. Now I want you to look at the shirt I'm wearing, just briefly. The shirt I'm wearing is called Under Armour. This is the exact same thing as the intersection of those two cells. The very beginning of humanity. The intersection of the first two cells began a race of beings that were twins, Cain and Abel. What's really fascinating is when you put the words together, cannibal. The whole system is cannibalistic. One kills the other. And that's what Satan feeds off. That is his source of energy. That's where Satan gets his energy from souls, because we know by the Bible that Satan prowls around like a roaring lion seeking whom he may devour. And we're devoured from the inside. That's why they built the Twin Towers. The Twin Towers are merely a representation of the seed of the serpent and the seed of the woman, like the story of the wheat and the weeds growing together in Matthew 13. So Satan built those towers on purpose. Satan used humans as a host body to build those two towers to represent the Garden of Eden, the twins, Cain and Abel, the seed of the serpent, the seed of the woman, the wheat and the weeds. It's all the same. So those towers were purposely built in order to be destroyed, in order to make a public proclamation at the end of the world that Satan has achieved the new host body, because the two were destroyed and in their place a new tower was built. And that tower that was built is called the One World Freedom Tower. And at the very top of that tower, Barack Obama wrote his name and he wrote, "We remember, we rebuild, we come back stronger." He used the word "we" and then the word "we" and then the word "we" on purpose to show that Satan's government has rebuilt. WWW is 666. So now I've explained to you biblically where this new government comes from, the government that runs the earth. By the way, the word for govern means to rule, and that's what the word govern means. I told you this is the government of Satan. That's why you'll see that very image on the grounds in Washington. It's called the Washington Monument, and in the very center of this is a circle with an X if you look straight down from below, because we have the obelisk in the dead center, which represents the penis of Osiris. And I'm sorry, that's just what it is. I'm not gonna be squeamish about talking about what this stuff is. So there it is. You'll see this in Washington, D.C. It's called the Washington Monument. So now we're gonna continue this section and we're gonna give you the evidence so you can put this together.
Here we see the account of Genesis 3 in the Bible. The word for serpent is H5175, Nakash. The word originates because of the sound it makes when speaking, a hiss, representing a serpent. Again, we see in Genesis 3 that the word for woman is H802. In the definition, we also see adulteress as the first refinement from that Hebrew word. The translation for touch in Genesis 3:3 is naga, which means to lay the hand upon for any purpose, euphemistically, to lie with a woman.
But the serpent said to the woman, "You will not surely die, for God knows that when you eat of it, your eyes will be opened, and you will be like God, knowing good and evil." So when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, and that it was a delight to the eyes, and that the tree was to be desired to make one wise, she took of its fruit and ate. And she also gave some to her husband who was with her, and he ate. Then the eyes of both were opened.
So now I want to talk about Genesis, because we showed you these words. We showed you that the word woman means adulteress in Genesis 3. And that's the translation of the King James Version. We showed you that the word to touch means euphemistically to lie with a woman. So you have adulteress, lie with a woman, and a nakash. Okay, so that's just taking the straight up King James Version of the Bible and going to the concordance and just looking up simply the definitions of the words. So it's very clear and very obvious that this is not just about a piece of fruit. Now, a lot of people want to argue whether or not eat means eat. If you go look up the word eat, it means to consume. There's a variety of definitions even for the word itself. So I don't know how much everybody knows about biology, but in each host body, parent, you have each one donating chromosomes for the production of a new child. If you have the seed of the serpent and the seed of the woman, the serpent produces 23 chromosomes and so does the woman. Okay, whenever sexual intercourse occurs, you have an egg and you have a sperm. Now, each one produces for the new host body 23 chromosomes. That's just basic biology. So you have 23 and 23, and that makes 46, and that's what the new child has. The new child has 46 chromosomes. That completes the chromosomes for the new host body. Let's call the host body the temple, because the Bible says, "Do you not know you are the temple of God, and the Spirit of God dwelleth in you?" That's after you get saved. But our bodies are a temple. Now, I want you to consider this, that in 9/11, after the destruction of the Twin Towers, George Bush read Psalm 23. Okay, well, there were Twin Towers that were destroyed. So 23 and 23, you know, 23 and 23, that represents the two that would be donating the chromosomes, the paternal and maternal parent. Now, once those towers were destroyed, Barack Hussein Obama, lightning from heaven, had to throw that in, he read Psalm 46.
Be still and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the nations, will be exalted in the earth.
In Psalm 46, he read the words, be still and know that I am God. Well, a lot of people will say, no, he was just reading Psalm 46. No, he wasn't. It was Satan using a host body, proclaiming himself to be God, having rebuilt his host body, which is a new temple for Satan to occupy and to literally run, because it is the new formation, it is the new temple for Satan to occupy, and that's what it represents. Now that we've already been to Genesis 3 in the King James Bible, we've shown you what the word serpent means. It doesn't mean a snake. It is serpent because of the hissing sound it makes when it speaks. Also the word woman. They could have picked a lot of other words for the word woman other than one that means adulteress. Also for the word to touch, to lay with, as laying with a woman. So in all those translations of those words straight out of the King James Bible, we have a very obvious scenario that's been painted, that there was a fornication that occurred in the garden. Now, when you go to the Targum, which predates this, the Targum was the way the rabbinical teachers would sit people around and they would teach them the Pentateuch, the first five books of the Bible. And so we read to you that out of that also, that Hava had desired the angel, and she bare a son, Cain, and then she also produced his twin, even Abel, from Adam. And so now we have a picture in the Garden of Eden of twins. So the very first children that were born were twins. I just want you to think about that for a sec. We wanted you to see the reality that there was massive death that occurred. We wanted you to see the violence of it. We wanted you to see the horror of that particular scene. I wanted to make it real for you because those were real people that died. Now, here's what I want to point out. Those words, exitus octa probat, those words are written on that arch. It's called the Washington Arch. Those words mean the outcome justifies the deed. Well, you were watching people die. I mean, you were watching the Twin Towers go down. There's no outcome that I could really think of that could justify that as being the deed. And I'm going to tie the Twin Towers to the words on that arch. And you might say, well, how are you going to do that? Sit tight. To understand the significance of the Twin Towers and the destruction of the Twin Towers on that particular date that was 9/11, you must understand your biblical history. Okay, I told you we are the temple of God. Our bodies are a temple, and the Spirit of God dwells in you once you get born again. Until that, you have a different spirit running you. That's why the Bible says you must be born again. You must be born of the Spirit. Now, in order to understand this, you must understand that there was a temple in Jerusalem where everybody went for prayer, and that was destroyed on 9/11. It was the 9th of Av. And so if you look at the Jewish calendar, it was the 9th day of the 11th month. It's called Av on the civil calendar. So on 9/11, back in history, Nebuchadnezzar destroyed the first temple in Jerusalem on the 9th of Av. The temple was rebuilt, and after the temple was rebuilt, later it was destroyed by Titus, the emperor, and he destroyed it, oddly enough, on the exact same day, on the 9th of Av. So you gotta be kidding me, right? Well, that's what Jesus was talking about in Matthew 24. When his disciples came and said, hey, look at all these beautiful buildings. Jesus said to his disciples, verily I say unto you, there shall not be one stone left upon another that shall not be thrown down. And Jesus was talking about the coming destruction of the temple. He also was telling us about the destruction of our bodies as the temple when he was speaking to the Jews. Jesus said to the Jews, destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it up. And the Jews said, it took 46 years to build the temple. 46, the number of completed chromosomes. They said, it took 46 years to build the temple. How can you rebuild it in 3 days? And Jesus said, well, you've heard what I said, but you haven't understood its meaning. Because we know that Jesus rose from the dead after 3 days. He had his temple, which is his body, rebuilt. I want to throw in a scripture real quick. The Bible says we all anxiously await the redemption of our bodies. We have the first temple that was destroyed on the 9th of Av, 9/11. The second temple destroyed by Titus on the 9th of Av. Don't forget the name Titus. It's coming back in just a little bit. And then, oddly enough, we have the Twin Towers destroyed on 9/11. Do you think that's a little coincidental? Okay, where did the number 9/11 come from as an emergency number? Well, it originated actually in England with the number 999. Well, if you turn 999 upside down, that's 666. And if you're using a rotary phone like the old days where you had to dial the number, 9's way down here. So if you gotta go all the way back and you're in a hurry, that doesn't make a lot of sense, does it? But the number was for 9/11 was originated in 1967 through the Federal Communications Bureau of the government in league with AT&T, which it was owned by the Rockefellers. Okay, so the Rockefellers had a hand in the phone company that came up with the number 911, kind of like 9/11. It happens to be on every police car and every emergency vehicle, 911. Okay, well, let's look at some other stuff. In 1967, David Rockefeller was on the cover of Newsweek magazine. He has his watch prominently displayed in the photograph. The number on his watch is 911. That's a little odd. What's really odd is the back of that magazine. There's two people that are wearing shirts, I think, for a type of cigarette. They have these two long red, looks like red twin towers on their shirts. And we're going to show you that right now. And just to give you a little bit of data, that's where the number for 9/11 came from. Rockefellers were instrumental in it. They were the owners of the company at the time. And it came out in actually 1968. Shortly after David Rockefeller posed on the cover of the magazine. All right, here we go. This is where we tie it all together. Okay, we've shown you, you know, the all from the Garden of Eden and the government that was established back then was a twin paradigm within each human being. I am my own worst enemy. I have my own evil twin. You have your own evil twin, a good one and a bad one. That's the government. Now, it's time to tie this thing all together. We've already given you the facts about the Rockefellers. We're going to give you a few more right now that's going to tie this whole thing completely together. I don't know if y'all know this, but the Rockefellers are one of the owners of the Federal Reserve. They print the fiat currency, so they make the bills. That's going to be very significant here in just a minute. Before we continue with that, you need to know the definition of the word apotheosis. The word apotheosis means man becoming a god. That's the definition of the word. Deification from man to God. That's exactly what the serpent told Eve. He said, your eyes will be open and you will be as gods. That's why in Genesis 3:22, it says, the Lord God said, man has become as one of us. Right there, that is apotheosis. Man has become as one of us, gods, knowing good and evil. And then it says, and unless he reach out his hand and take from the tree of life and live forever. So the only way to get back is to take from the tree of life, which is Christ. Now, I want to throw this in right now. There's a club called the Skull and Bones Club, and the number is 322. Okay, we have lots of politicians and world leaders that have been members of that club. It is Genesis 3:22. They know. They know the truth. They are operatives of the devil. They are literally demonic agents that run governments, run businesses, run society, you know, like the Boys Club. So anyway, the Skull and Bones Club, they're mocking us because the serpent said, you will not die. The serpent lied. We died. You're going to see some commercials after this section where you're just going to go, you're not even going to believe what you're going to see. So, apotheosis means man becoming God. Okay, the Rockefellers make the fiat currency, the United States fiat currency, the bills. Now, there's three arches we need to talk about very quickly. There is the Arch of Triumph at Palmyra. That's actually called the Arch of Baal. Okay, it is an archway that was the entrance to the Temple of Baal. I don't know if y'all know what that is, but if you do, you know that it was the entrance to the temple where in the Old Testament they would go in and sacrifice humans and their children to Baal. They would throw babies into a fire live, and they would have bisexual orgies at the very time they were doing these human sacrifices. So the archway, the Arch of Baal, it's called the Arch of Triumph in Palmyra. It is the entrance to the Temple of Baal, okay? Now, there's another arch. It's called the Arch of Titus. Remember, Titus destroyed the temple in Jerusalem in 70 AD? The one that Jesus said would happen. Jesus told his disciples, this temple will be destroyed. And the guy that destroyed the temple in 70 AD was Titus. Well, there's an arch that was built, and it's called the Arch of Triumph, just like the Arch of Baal. It's called the Arch of Triumph, and it's to commemorate Titus's victory over the Jews and to commemorate the destruction of the temple. In that archway, under the soffit, you know, the part underneath, there's an image of Titus, and it's called the Apotheosis of Titus on the Arch of Titus. It's Arch of Triumph, man becoming a god. Okay, in downtown Manhattan, we have another arch. It's called the Arch of Washington. Well, here's a very fascinating common denominator. If you walk into the Capitol building and you look up at the rotunda, you'll see a giant fresco that's painted on the ceiling. I think it's 180 feet above the ground. I believe so. Which would be 666, by the way. And on that fresco, it shows George Washington, and he's looking down, and he's amongst the clouds, and it's called the Apotheosis of Washington, which means man becoming a god, Washington becoming a god. If you look closely, if you're looking at Washington, you'll see a banner that says E Pluribus Unum, many out of one. And it's upside down, the banner is. That's very significant because that's where we all came from. We have the Arch of Baal. We have the Arch of Titus. They're all called the Arch of Triumph, the Arch of Titus. And then we have the Arch of Washington. And Washington has an apotheosis associated with his name in the rotunda. So the arch that you're looking at in downtown Manhattan is an arch that represents apotheosis, man becoming God. Okay, well, it used to be that when you look through the Arch of Washington in Manhattan, all you would see is sky. But then David and Nelson Rockefeller, they condemned all these businesses. They served eminent domain, I believe in over 150 businesses, and they forced all these business owners to move out. And guess what they built there? They built the Twin Towers in this location where they served eminent domain. Well, if you're looking through the Arch of Washington, the Twin Towers were built dead center of the arch. Let's see, it's right there in black and white. The Arch of Washington was modeled after the Arch of Titus, which means apotheosis. So when you're looking through that arch and you realize that the Rockefellers built the Twin Towers dead center of that arch so you would see them, and then the Twin Towers were destroyed and all those people were sacrificed to the devil, just like they used to sacrifice them when they walked through the Arch of Baal into the Temple of Baal, and they would sacrifice people to the devil. It's the exact same thing. And to prove it, look at the US currency. All you have to do is look at the new $20 bill that was made in 1996. All you have to do is fold it into a pentagram and turn it upside down, and you will see the burning of the Twin Towers. And it represents DNA. The two DNA strips are identical to the Twin Towers. And then you look at the Twin Towers and they're burning, and that's the destruction of the temple, just like in the time of Titus.
And now I would suggest going back and watching my previous video titled Tribulation Kickoff Events, The Phoenix Rising, because this is the next order out of chaos type of event to bring about the rise of the Antichrist in the one world government. The destruction of the Hoover Dam and a tsunami hitting New York City is going to be the symbolic birthing event of the Antichrist that will rise from all the destruction and the chaos that's coming. And this will bring about Satan's one world government and the mark of the beast. I hope you can see what's being revealed to you, because this is not Rich Montblu. This is the Lord God revealing it and pouring out his spirit through me to show you that we have come to the end of the cycle. The birthing event of the Antichrist is about to happen, and these locusts are going to be birthed out of the pit, and they are going to sting whoever does not have the seal of God in them. In the book of Daniel, verse 12:4, Daniel was told to shut up the words and seal the book until the end of times, and that many people would run to and fro and knowledge would increase at the end of the world. Never in human history have we had the ability to just jump on a plane, jump on a train, or jump in our cars to go wherever we wanted. Never in human history have we ever had access in the palm of our hands to all the information that we ever needed. Never in human history did we have machine learning and artificial intelligence and then D-Wave quantum computing to access information from different worlds. And more important, never before has knowledge increased in understanding of the Word of God, as you can see what was revealed in this video. When the Lord first revealed himself to me, I was on fire, but then I caved to the pressures of this world. I caved to the pressures of my friends and my wife, and I backslid into the world and started living my life as I previously did before I was saved. And then one day I was driving down the street and the Lord put on my mind Final Choice as I was looking at this sign, and I knew that was him speaking to me saying, you need to choose. I've revealed myself to you and this is your final choice. As I was praying to the Lord how to wrap up this video, he led me to the word Laodicea. He put that on my mind, which led me to Revelation 3:14 through 22, the letter to the church of Laodicea. I'm going to have Max McLean read it to us, and then I'm going to explain to you what is meant to this letter of the church of Laodicea afterwards, and also apply it to the relevance of this video.
To the angel of the church in Laodicea write, these are the words of the Amen, the faithful and true witness, the ruler of God's creation. I know your deeds, that you are neither cold nor hot. I wish you were either one or the other. So because you are lukewarm, neither hot nor cold, I am about to spit you out of my mouth. You say,
I am rich, I have acquired wealth, and do not need a thing. But you do not realize that you are wretched, pitiful, poor, blind, and naked. I counsel you to buy from me gold refined in the fire, so you can become rich, and white clothes to wear, so you can cover your shameful nakedness, and salve to put on your eyes so you can see. Those whom I love I rebuke and discipline. So be earnest and repent. Here I am. I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come in and eat with that person and they with me. To the one who is victorious, I will give the right to sit with me on my throne, just as I was victorious and sat down with my Father on his throne. Whoever has ears, let them hear what the Spirit says to the churches.
From the beginning of creation of Adam and Eve, evidence of the Lord's Spirit has been written into the DNA of every human being. It's called our conscience, knowing right from wrong. So whether you believe in the redemptive work of Christ or not, every human being, even the atheists, know that in their heart, our conscience is a result of an intelligent creator and not some accident that resulted from the Big Bang in space. Jesus says in Romans 20, "For the visible things of God from the creation of the world are clearly seen, being understood by things that are made, even his eternal power and Godhead, so that we are without excuse." Jesus is speaking to the church of Laodicea, which represents everyone who is lukewarm in their belief. That means you know in your heart the truth about our Creator, but because we believe we are in control of our own destiny through our own will, we choose to remain blissfully ignorant and would rather deceive ourselves, as one of my closest friends once told me, so that we continue in our own selfish pursuits and remain living a life of sin and unrighteousness with no accountability. So we never come to that reality of our true nature of ourselves and how sinful we really are, because once you are born again with the Spirit of Christ, the Holy Spirit reveals to you your sinful nature, and you become ashamed of what you've done in the past, and all you want to do is repent and seek what the Lord's will is for you. This is why Jesus is going to spew these types of people out of his mouth when he comes to judge the world. Because in your heart, you've chosen to love both good and evil in God's eyes. You've chosen to accept not the truth. You cannot do what is evil in the Lord's eyes and say that you're a good person and expect to be redeemed. It's called self-delusion. In this video, I provided undeniable visual and scriptural evidence of the truth that your soul is being hunted to transmute your spiritual energy into a race of serpent scorpion locusts that will be birthed out of the pit in the end times, which proves that both Satan and Jesus are very real. So my question is to all who watch this video, what will you do with this information? Will you reject the free gift of salvation that you have in Jesus Christ so that you can continue pursuing the material things of this world and the desires of the flesh and living a life of sin? Or will you believe in the one who came into the system to die for your sins so that you could be reconciled back to the Heavenly Father of where we originally came from before we were exiled from our rebellion? I believe in making this video, the Lord is having me tell you that you have a final choice, a choice between living in this world and serving the Antichrist, or believing in the redemptive work of Christ so that you can be redeemed out of this place before judgment comes, because it's going to be horrifying. That's the final choice you all need to make, and I pray that you make the right choice, and I hope this video blesses everyone.